a service of KIBMRadio.com, the Internet's home for an all-old-time radio.
Here is true. Only the names have been changed to protect the innocent.
Fatima Cigarettes, best of all long cigarettes, brings you Dragnet.
You're a detective sergeant. You're assigned to robbery detail. A small bakery shop in your city is held up. A man and his daughter are shot down without reason. Your job, get him.
If you want a long cigarette, smoke the best of all long cigarettes. Smoke extra mild Fatima. Yes, Fatima is the king-size cigarette which contains the finest Turkish and domestic tobaccos superbly blended to make it extra mild. To give Fatima a much different, much better flavor and aroma than any other long cigarette. That's why Fatima has more than doubled its smokers coast to coast. Enjoy extra mild Fatima yourself. Best of all, long cigarettes.
It's wise to smoke extra mild Fatima.
It's wise to smoke extra mild Fatima.
Dragnet, the documented drama of an actual crime. For the next 30 minutes, in cooperation with the Los Angeles Police Department, you will travel step by step on the side of the law through an actual case from official police files. From beginning to end, from crime to punishment, Dragnet is the story of your police force in action.
It was Tuesday, November 3rd. It was chilly in Los Angeles. We were working the night watch out of robbery detail. My partner's Ben Romero. The boss is Captain Ed Walker. My name's Friday. It was 5 minutes to midnight when we got to 318 Silver Avenue, Stendel's bakery shop.
Yeah?
Romero and Friday sent for robbery.
Hi, I'm Jacobs, unit 16R. My partner Olson's back there in the shop talking to the owner.
You answered the call, did you?
Yeah, must have been a crazy man. Shot two of them down, cold blood. There they go in the ambulance now. Shot up pretty bad.
Mm-hmm. Who runs the place?
Swedish family named Stendahl. Father, mother, two daughters. All four of them work in the bakery here.
Mm-hmm. They all here at the time of the robbery?
Yeah, the holdup man shot the father and the oldest daughter. The mother and the younger girl are in the back, straight through that door.
Okay. Thanks, James.
Right, Sergeant.
Joe. You know, on the side of the door here, looks like a bullet hole.
Yeah. Hey, Jacob.
Yes, Sergeant.
You want to call into the crime lab, ask them to send somebody out?
Right.
Thank you.
Hi, you Olson?
That's right.
Romero and Friday, Central Robbery.
Oh, how are you? These are two of the victims, Mrs. Signe Stendel. The girl's her daughter, name's Jennifer.
Any other witnesses?
Not so far. Neighborhood around here is pretty deserted this time of night. Hold-up man made a fast getaway.
And two people who were shot, what kind of shape are they in?
The father, Mr. Stendel, he's got a bullet wound in the right shoulder. Older daughter's a lot worse. Her name's June, 19 years old, shot 4 or 5 times through the stomach.
Mm-hmm. You want to stand by?
Right, yeah.
Okay. Mrs. Stendel, we're from robbery detail.
Yeah, how do you do?
How do you do?
Yeah, worse than Alexei. I'm 6 plats for hire in a stool.
Yes, Mama.
You will excuse me for not getting up, officer. I don't feel so well.
It's perfectly all right, ma'am.
Chair for you, officer.
Well, thank you. I'll get it.
Thank you very much. You and your daughter here were in the front of the bakery shop at the time of the robbery. Is that right, Miss Stendel?
No. Jenny was back here with her father. That's Lars, my husband. Jenny and I were in the shop in front.
Oh, who were you with, ma'am?
Jenny and I.
Joe?
Mama means June, my older sister. She calls her June.
Yeah, June.
Oh, well.
Do you mind telling us what happened?
Well, June and I was scrubbing the floor of the shop. Every Tuesday night, we scrubbed the floor of the shop. Then this man came in and pointed a gun. He wanted our money.
About what time did he come in?
11:15, 11:20. I don't remember for certain. He wanted our money, and I gave it to him.
How much was that, ma'am?
$24.
$24.
Just the paper money. He took it and put it in his pocket. Yun, my daughter, she started to cry. The man hit her. She cried some more. Then Lars and Jenny came running from the back.
Yes, ma'am.
The man pointed the gun. He made Lars and me and Jenny stand against that wall. But not Yun. He took hold of her. Jenny, who served today? Then Regan, the man, and but Yun.
It was getting fresh with her, Mom. The man tried to get fresh with June officers. June hit him. He tried to drag her out the door with...
Yeah, Yun hit him. Hit him good. And he went like that, threw her against the counter and pushed June down. Crazy man. Crazy look. He kicked her.
Mm-hmm.
Then Lars, my husband, he ran at the man. He heard the gun loud. And Lars fell down.
And I screamed.
Yeah, and I screamed. I turned and I saw the man standing over you. He pointed the gun down at her.
Yes, ma'am.
Crazy look on him. He kept shooting her 4, maybe 5 times. Yuni screamed. She kept screaming. The man ran out the door.
It's all right now, Miss Linda.
Had either one of you ever seen this man before?
No,
neither did I.
Would you know him if you saw him again?
Yeah, I think so.
I would, officer. I got a good look at him. He was wearing a blue cap like a baseball player wears.
Mm-hmm. How'd he get away? Was he on foot or did he have a car?
Nobody followed him, but after he left, I heard a car start up down the block and then it drove away.
Do you have anything else to add, Mrs. Stendhal?
I hope you catch the man. He's bad. Please catch him.
Yes, ma'am. We're going to try.
Yen. For Snellock, here, my Nichols, your friend Cassie.
Yes, ma'am. Here, Mama.
Here, officer. When you find the man, please call me.
You keep the nickels. We'll call you. Before we left the scene of the robbery and shooting, Mrs. Stendhal and her daughter gave us their description of the holdup man, together with the clothing he wore. The suspect had no outstanding physical characteristics that they'd noticed. The only thing unusual about his clothing was that he wore what appeared to be a baseball cap at the time of the holdup. She described the cap as light blue with a visor. Together with officers Bechtel and Lopez from Central Robbery, we canvassed the immediate neighborhood for other possible witnesses. We found none. The next morning, we went out to the hospital. The condition of the older daughter, June, was critical. We interviewed the father. He could tell us nothing. At 10 a.m., Mrs. Stendhal and her younger girl, Jenny, were brought to the office, and we started them looking through mug books of parolees previously convicted of armed robbery. Within 2 hours, both of them positively identified the picture of a recent San Quentin release as that of the holdup man. His name was Harold Best. We started a quick rundown.
You pulled the package on?
Yeah, here's the dope. Harold Best. Alias Harold Norris, alias Harold Thompson, alias Tom Norris. One term for armed robbery in Q. Got out 4 months ago. Ammo and description both match.
How about the ex-con files? You checking?
He's registered. Did you get a hold of his parole officer?
Yeah, 2440 Excelsior Avenue. His rooming house.
Well, that checks with the ex-con files.
Parole officer says Best went to work 2 weeks ago at a filling station over on Vermont.
Yeah?
Doesn't seem to be able to hold a job. Quarrelsome. Run himself into debt. I got it. Robbery, Romero. Yeah, Ray. That's all, huh? Yeah. Right, bye. Ray Pinker at the crime lab. They checked the slugs taken from the two victims.
Yeah?
They came from a .32 caliber revolver. Probably a Colt.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
That's it. Not too bad a start.
We've had worse.
Yeah. Maybe we can make that phone call pretty quick.
2 p.m. Wednesday. Ben and I drove out to his rooming house at 2440 Excelsior Avenue, and we found that Herbert Best was still living there. We had the landlady show us his room. Besides the usual personal belongings, we came across nothing of consequence. After questioning the landlady, we drove to the service station on Vermont Avenue where Best was supposed to be employed.
I don't see anyone around.
Well, hey, there's a fellow over there greasing your car in there, right?
Oh, yeah. That looks like Best.
Mm-hmm. Hey, fella. You.
Yeah?
Can you tell us if there's a Herbert Best working here?
Sure, I'm him. Why?
Police officers would like to talk to you.
Yeah? What's the matter?
Routine investigation. Got a few questions for you.
Supposed to have this car greased up a quarter to four. What am I supposed to do, please? You or the boss?
I'll find him, Joe. You got any heat on you?
No. What's it all about?
How long is this going to be?
A couple minutes. Won't take more than a grease job. Put this thing in shape.
Well, we'll wait for you.
How'd you find me? A nosy landlady of mine?
No, routine channel.
Every fetting on this trap is froze. Piece of junk. Well, what's it all about?
Got a few things to straighten out, Best. How long you been working here?
Well, you didn't drive out here for that. That's not your game. What's the pitch?
Routine investigation. We'd like to know where you've been spending your nights.
For instance?
Sunday night. Where were you?
Well, I don't know. I went to a show. Yeah, I saw a Mickey Rooney picture.
Where?
Downtown. I had a beer after the show. Come home.
Well, how about Monday night?
Well, I went home after work. I was pooped. Went to bed early.
Can you prove it?
Landlady saw me come in, always snooping around. She ought to know if I was there or not.
How about last night, Tuesday?
Played some cards with a friend of mine, him and his wife, Penny Annie Booker.
Where?
Their place. It's down on Pico, near the park. You can ask them.
What time did you get there?
Well, I'm not sure. About 8 o'clock, I guess.
What time did you leave?
What's it all about?
What time did you leave?
Around midnight, yeah. Must have been around midnight.
What'd you play with your friend and his wife?
Poker. I lost as usual. Took a streetcar home, went to bed.
Sure you didn't leave earlier?
Of course I'm sure. It was around midnight, I remember.
How do you remember?
I looked at my watch. Good enough for you?
What time did you get home?
Well, it takes about half hour on a trolley. Must have been about 12:30.
Did your landlady see you come in?
I don't know if she saw me or not. Always snooping around. Probably did.
You're not sure?
No, of course I'm not sure. She looks for me. I don't look for her.
You want a gun, Best?
You know better than that, copper. Ex-cons can't have a gun.
Your friend and his wife. Now, they're going to back you up if you were playing cards with them till midnight?
Why not? I was. Say, there's a boss looking for me. I better let him know I'm here.
Just a minute, Best.
Yeah?
What's that you got in your back pocket there?
Yeah?
In your back pocket, the right one there.
Oh, this?
Yeah.
Baseball cap? Why?
4 p.m. Ben and I checked the suspect's locker at the service station and then drove him back to the office of the interrogation room. We continued questioning him. He denied any knowledge of the holdup and shooting at Stendahl's bakery shop the night before. We asked him again about the friends he was supposed to be playing cards with at the time of the robbery. He told us that they lived over on Pico, but he couldn't remember the address. He volunteered to direct us there, but he said they wouldn't be home. He told us their names were Mr. and Mrs. Clyde Mitchell, and that they were in charge of the food concessions at one of the football stadiums in town. Best was held for suspicion of robbery. That night, we drove out and interviewed the landlady at his boarding house. She knew nothing of Best's whereabouts the previous night. She didn't know what time he left or what time he returned. Ben and I went over his room again. There was no sign of a gun. Friday, 2 p.m., officers Beckel and Lopez went out to the hospital to see if Mr. Stendahl and his daughter, June, could identify Best's mugshot. Ben and I drove out to the stadium to locate Mr. and Mrs. Clyde Mitchell. It was a high school football game going on.
High school kids sure have a lot of fun nowadays.
Best years of your life, Joe.
You sound like you're 85.
Some nights I feel like it. The way those kids turn out for these things, you'd think USC and Notre Dame were playing.
You see the number on that gate over there?
Yeah, it's 23. Is that the number the gatekeeper gave me?
Yeah. Must be the Mitchell stand over there. Come on.
Well, miss, can you tell us where to find Mr. and Ms. Mitchell?
Yeah, around back of the stand. You knock on the door.
Thank you.
Yeah, come on in.
You Ms. Mitchell?
That's all right. What is it?
Police officer. I'd like to talk to you if you have a few minutes.
All right. I'm having a bite of lunch, but come on in. Shut the door.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Lousy food business. You never get a chance to feed yourself.
Yes, ma'am.
Hey, care for some of these? New kind of potato chips. Revolutionary, it says.
Oh?
Mother Thompson's puff chips, flavored. Get all kinds, see? These here are a combination. See. Garlic and eggplant. Sure tastes different, have some?
No, thank you.
I would. Thank you. See, we're inquiring about a friend of yours, Ms. Mitchell. Maybe you can tell us something about him.
Oh, who's that?
A man by the name of Herbert Best.
Herb, yeah. Old-time friend of my husband's. What do you want to know?
You see him quite often, do you, Ms. Mitchell?
Mm-hmm. Once, twice a month. Claude and I play cards or go out bowling with him. Herb's pretty good company.
Uh-huh. When's the last time you saw him?
Early this week, Tuesday, I think it was.
Sure, it was Tuesday.
See, yeah. It was. We played cards. Why?
That's your play?
That's right, a little poker. Clyde and Herb and me.
What time did Best get to your place, Ms. Mitchell?
Well, right after I finished up with the dinner dishes, around 7:45, I'd say.
Mm-hmm. How long did he stay?
A couple of hours. We sat around, had a few drinks, played poker, nickel limit.
What time did he leave? Do you remember that?
A little before 10, I think.
I'm sure that, ma'am, is important.
Sure as I can be. Must have left before 10 because Clyde and I listened to the 10 o'clock news alone. Then we went to bed right after.
Your friend Best tells us he didn't leave your place until midnight.
Oh, that's not right. We must be mixed up. He left before 10, I'm sure of that.
All right, Ms. Mitchell. Thank you.
Say, I hope I haven't said anything I shouldn't have. I know Herb's next con.
Yeah.
He likes to gamble. You're not checking up on him for Tuesday night, are you?
That's right.
You playing too much poker?
We're not playing enough. 3:30 p.m. We located Mr. Mitchell, corroborated his wife's story, and then we went back to the city hall. Officers Becklin and Lopez were waiting for us. They told us that they had seen Mr. Stendahl and his daughter, June, at the hospital. Both of them had identified Herbert Best's mugshot as that of the holdup man. At a show-up, Mrs. Stendahl and her daughter identified Best. We checked auto records for all stolen cars that might tie in. There were none. We then started to work on the theory that he had taken a bus from his friend's place where he had been playing cards to the Stendahl bakery where the shooting took place. Lopez and Bechtel rode the bus over the same route. It took 43 minutes. Plenty of time for Best to have gotten from one place to the other, even on a slow run. We interviewed the bus driver who'd been on duty that particular line Tuesday night between 10 p.m. and midnight. He identified Best as one of his passengers, but he didn't remember where he got off. The next morning, Ben and I met with Ed Walker, captain of robbery.
Hi. How's it make out?
Just saw the deputy DA. Laid out the case for him.
Yeah?
We got the complaint. He'll be arraigned this afternoon.
How strong a case you got?
Well, each one of the Stendahl family identified Best. His alibi didn't stand up for Tuesday night.
Uh-huh.
And we got that bus driver. He tapped Best, too. And that blue baseball cap. All we need now is the holdup gun.
I hate to spoil it for you.
Hmm?
This letter just came through in the mail. Have a look.
Okay.
What do you think?
I read in the paper this morning about Herbert Best. You got the wrong guy. I'm the one who held up that bakery.
Every detail about that robbery is written down in that letter. The information wasn't in the newspaper story. Nobody else but the holdup man would know all those details.
Yeah, wait a minute, listen to this.
Yeah?
If you don't believe I'm the right man, I'll shoot up a couple of more jerks. Next time, I'll kill them.
It's no crank letter.
No, it isn't.
You got the wrong man.
Listening to Dragnet, the case history of a police investigation presented in the public interest by Fatima Cigarettes.
If you smoke a long cigarette, it will be in your interest to listen to this case history recorded by a typical Fatima smoker.
Hi there. My name is Bab Beckwith. Bab, that's short for Bethany Ann Beckwith. I live in New York City and I'm a fashion stylist. The other day at a showing of the new fall styles, I ran out of cigarettes. A friend of mine, a designer, introduced me to the new long Fatima. I really wish someone had told me about them sooner. Fatimas are a lot milder than the cigarettes I've been smoking. and they have a delightful flavor, too. I'm very glad to recommend them to you, because I know from experience it's wise to smoke extra mild Fatimas.
And more smokers every day are finding that out. Actual figures show extra mild Fatima has more than doubled its smokers coast to coast.
So enjoy extra mild Fatima yourself.
The king-size cigarette, which contains the finest Turkish and domestic tobaccos, superbly blended to make it extra mild.
You will prefer Fatima's much different, much better flavor and aroma.
You will agree.
It's wise to smoke extra mild Fatima.
It's wise to smoke extra mild Fatima.
The best of all long cigarettes.
After we received the anonymous letter in the mail confessing to the Stendhal Bakery holdup, we met with the deputy district attorney. We acquainted him with the new facts in the case. That afternoon, the charges against Herbert Best were dropped. We started again at the beginning. 10 a.m. Monday, November 9th. The members of the Stendhal family were again shown mug books of ex-cons with robbery records. This time, they picked out 8 mug shots of known robbery men, each with a marked resemblance to the original suspect, Herbert Best. Together with officers Bechtel and Lopez, we started checking them out. The first 2 days, we tracked down 4 of the 8. All of the 4 were in the clear. 5:15 p.m., we got back to the city hall, the carpool.
See any empty spots, Joe?
No, but don't park it in any one of the city councilman's stalls.
Yeah, it might get sore.
Well, why don't you pull up here? Boyd will take care of it.
Yeah, okay.
That's good right here.
Doggone it. I knew there's something I forgot to do.
What's that?
Oh, they had an underwear sale today. That place down in South Fig. Shorts, T-shirts.
Mm-hmm.
Wife told me to be sure and get down there.
Well, that'll be another one. That place has sales all the time, don't they?
Only twice a year on underwear. Stuff I've got's not going to last till next time.
Friday? Ben? Wait a minute.
Jim Beck.
Hi, Beck.
Hi. Well?
Yeah. How'd you make out?
Two men we checked were clean. We picked up something 77th Street station. Now, go ahead, Ben.
Mm-hmm. Watch that elevated door, Jim.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Well, what's with 77th Street?
Oh, a couple of men in traffic out there covered an accident this afternoon. 91st and Central hit and run.
That's so?
One of our traffic cars saw the collision and took out after the guy. Chased him 10 blocks.
Mm-hmm.
And while they were chasing him, they thought they saw the driver throw something out of the car window.
Yeah, what?
Well, I'm coming to that. When they finally pulled the car over, gray coupe, the driver told him his shoulder was wrenched in the accident. He was on his way to his own doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Our men took him to 77th Street, had the doc there look at him.
Yeah.
Well, the doc was treating the guy. Only one of the officers was in the room.
Mm-hmm.
When he turned to get a drink of water, the suspect slugged him, and then the doctor jumped out of the window and got away. Teletypes out on him.
He went through an awful lot of trouble to beat a traffic rap.
Yeah, that's the way to impress the boys out there. They got out of broadcast, and the guy went back to the spot where they thought they saw the guy toss this thing out of his car when they were chasing him.
Did it pay off?
They found a .32 Colt revolver. Arrest camp's checking it now over in the crime lab.
What did they say the man looked like?
Description measures pretty close to our holdup guy.
I'll get it. Robbery Friday. Yeah, just a minute. It's you, Ben.
Oh, thanks. Yeah. Oh, yeah, Russ. Yeah. Okay, fine, right. Russ Camp checked the .32 revolver with the slugs in the Stendhal case.
Yeah.
Positive make.
The gray coupe, which the unidentified suspect had been driving, had been checked out by traffic officers at 77th Street Division. They had found that the owner and driver of the car was a man named Bruno Stock, a two-time loser with a page full of major and minor crimes to his credit. We checked his mama sheet, and we got out a broadcast on him in an APB. A stakeout had been placed at his last known address. We picked up a sandwich and a cup of coffee for dinner, and then we started checking out Bruno Stock's relatives and friends. By 6 o'clock the following night, we still had no idea where he was. A little after 9 p.m., we got a call from an informant who told us that a Tommy Josephson, a small-time thief and reputedly a friend of Bruno Stock's, wanted to talk to us. We found him in a small apartment over on West 6th.
One thing I want to set you straight on. Bruno's no friend of mine. He's in on the heavy rackets. No heavy racket man's a friend of mine.
All right, we got it. Now, where's Bruno?
He came here tonight, 6:15, moved right in on me, didn't even ask me.
What do you want with you?
Now, you remember, Bruno's no friend of mine.
Yeah, we got that. Now, what do you want?
A gun. He knew I had one. I keep it for self-protection. You can't trust these heavy men.
Did you give him the gun?
Give it to him. He took it. shook me down like a rat. Made me go out and buy dinner for him. My own dog. Have to bring it back here for him.
Yeah.
Bruno's no friend of mine. What he does with that gun is his grief. It's out of my hands.
When did he leave here?
An hour ago, I think. Maybe a little less. Shook me down like a rat. Real heavy guy.
Where was Bruno going?
I don't know. He's crazy. All them heavy guys are crazy. Talk like somebody with a paper head.
Can he tell you where he was going?
See a friend of his over in Dogtown. Guy runs a bowling alley. Bruno's going to borrow his car.
What for?
He's heavy, I tell you. Said he was going out on a heist tonight. Did he ever write you guys a letter?
Why?
Well, he told me he was going to prove what he wrote to you. Crazy. I didn't get it at all.
Yeah?
Said he was going out to kill a couple of jerks.
9:30 p.m. We got the address of the bowling alley run by Bruno Stock's friend, and we called the office. An alert for the suspect was broadcast immediately. Together with Gene Bechtel and Lopez, we drove to the bowling alley. Ben and I went in. Bechtel and Lopez covered the outside.
It's a good crowd. I wonder where they do business. I don't see any counter.
No, neither do I.
Oh, yeah. There it is. Way over in the corner.
Oh, yeah. There's nobody behind the cash register. How about that fellow in the white T-shirt standing by the cigarette machine?
Yeah, looks like he was. Here, let's go. Joe, guy with him. Just turned towards
Bruno, come on.
He sees us. He's going to the back.
All right, you. Let's hold it up. Come on.
He ducked in there to the right, Joe.
Down behind the alley. Hold it up, Stock.
The window, Joe.
He went right through it. Come on. Here.
There he is. Get out.
Joe?
He's in there, Beck. Cover the front.
Right.
Over the fence, Joe. There he is.
All right, give it back.
Yeah.
Come on.
You see?
No.
Got to be in the yard someplace.
Yeah.
Where'd it come from?
I can't see. Keep down.
Backstairs of that house. There he is.
Give it up, Stock. All right, mister.
Your tag.
Come on.
What's it look like?
Wait a minute. It's a shoulder wound.
Yeah.
You want to shake him down?
Yeah.
Joe, Ben, you all right?
Yeah. Get an ambulance, will you, Beck?
Right.
I'll throw the cuffs on him, huh?
Yeah. Well, that's it, Joe.
Yeah.
Where are you going?
I got a phone call to make.
The story you have just heard was true. Only the names were changed to protect the innocent. On February 18th, trial was held in Superior Court, Department 84, City and County of Los Angeles, State of California. In a moment, the results of that trial.
And now, here is our star, Jack Webb.
Thank you. In the Record Bureau of all metropolitan police departments, there's a special file in which all known criminals are cataloged and cross-indexed according to identifying marks. Marks which help the working detective. And so, with the cigarette. The outstanding identifying mark of Fatima is quality. The careful selection and blending of only the finest Turkish and domestic tobaccos to make Fatima extra mild. Now, if you're a long cigarette smoker, you'll find, like I did, that every pack is extra mild. You'll find it's the best of long cigarettes. Smoke Fatima.
Bruno Alfred Stock was tried and convicted of first-degree robbery and assault with intent to commit murder, two counts. Because of his prior convictions, he was adjudged an habitual criminal and sentenced to a life imprisonment. He is now serving his term in the state penitentiary. You have just heard Dragnet, a series of authentic cases from official files. Technical advice for Dragnet comes from the Office of Chief of Police W.H. Parker, Los Angeles Police Department.
Fatima Cigarettes, the best of all long cigarettes, has brought you Dragnet from Los Angeles.
Coming up, Duffy's Tavern. Next Tuesday, it's Fibber McGee on NBC.
My name's Regan. I work for Anthony J. Lyon, International Detective Bureau. They call me the Lion's Eye.
Wednesday at 9, and CBS brings you Jeff Regan, Investigator, starring Frank Graham as Regan with Frank Nelson as Anthony J. Lyon. So stand by for mystery and suspense and adventure in tonight's story of Some Enchanted Carhop.
It was just an ordinary drive-in hamburger joint on Vermont off Sunset, but they called it Hamburger Heaven. And just to carry out the idea, they'd hired six angels to wait on cars. Three blondes, a redhead, and two brunettes. I was lucky. I drew the redhead. Only she didn't serve up what I ordered. All she brought me was trouble. The whole thing started when there were only eight more shopping days until Christmas. I fought my way through the necktie and socks set, and by the time I reached the office, I was ready to start celebrating New Year's. But my boss, the Lion, had other ideas. When I walked in, all 280 pounds of him was up on an office stool. He was tacking a dried-up sprig of mistletoe over the door.
Jeffrey, my boy, come in. The festive season is at hand.
How's that again?
I said the festive season is at hand. I'm filled overflowing with the Yuletide spirit.
Yeah? Well, you better take those nails out of your teeth before you spring a leak.
Hmm? Oh, yes. Yeah, yes, you're right, my boy. I got carried away.
Yeah, sure. You and Tiny Tim. We're expecting women clients?
Women clients? Oh, you mean the mistletoe. Well, Jeffrey, you never can tell when a sweet young thing might accidentally happen in.
Stop drooling, Fatso. You dropped out of a mistletoe set 50 pounds ago.
Well, maybe so. But I still believe in Santa Claus. Now, where was I?
You were up on the stool with berries in your hair.
No, I mean about the new client. And what have I told you so far?
That the festive season is at hand.
Huh? Then I haven't told you about our new client. His name is Ward Hamilton, Jeffrey. He was in just a few minutes ago. Fine figure of a man. Well-dressed, distinguished, and prosperous.
That explains the Christmas spirit. How much?
Jeffrey, the Christmas spirit cannot be measured in terms of money. This is the time of goodwill toward men of unselfish devotion.
Sure. How much unselfish devotion did he buy?
$50 worth. It's something about his niece or daughter or some friend or something.
What about them?
Well, it seems this girl's been receiving packages, flowers, candy, that sort of thing.
Well, what's so mysterious about that? Doesn't she know it's Christmas?
Well, for some reason or other, Ward Hamilton says she's worried about them. He'll tell you all about it when you see him. The address is on the desk. It's out on Iredale Road in North Hollywood.
So I find the Santa Claus that's been sending the packages.
Say... That's right. This case does fit right in with the season, doesn't it?
Sure. And Merry Christmas to you, too, Fatso. That started it. I hopped in my sleigh and headed my reindeer out over Cahuenga Pass. Iredell Road was twin rows of California bungalows with Christmas decorations strung out in front. All except one house. It was the address Lyon had given me. Redwood front on the usual cream-colored stucco. White ranch-type fence, swimming pool in the backyard. No Christmas anywhere. Behind the fence, a big Dalmatian wagged his tail and grinned at me in a nice, friendly sort of way. Only he was growling when he did it. I circled wide and made the porch, but I didn't get as far as the doorbell.
What do you want?
Well, Mr. Hamilton? I'm Regan, International.
Regan? Oh, yes, the detective. Come in, Mr. Regan, come in.
He was big and gray-haired, the man of distinction. But what he had in his hand wasn't a glass. It was a whip, black, 10 feet long, with lead weights at the tip.
In here. I appreciate your coming right out, Mr. Regan. I'd like to get prompt action.
Is that what you use that for?
Well, the whip. No. No, just a hobby of mine. I practice hitting toy ducks floating in the swimming pool.
Oh, nice way to get use out of your pool during the winter season.
Well, yes. Never mind that. Now, sit down, Mr. Regan. I want to tell you about Mary.
That's the niece.
Niece? No. No relation. I'm a close friend of her family's. Her parents died several years ago. There was no one else, so I've tried to take over the reins and help the girl along. It hasn't been easy.
She isn't broken to harness.
It's a nice metaphor, but it doesn't fit. Not at all. Mary Winter is a strange girl. Very strange.
She's the shy, retiring type.
Ah, I see. The detective training. You're thinking ahead, assuming that she's not attractive to men. Nothing could be further from the truth. She's a lovely girl. Very lovely. Auburn hair, green eyes, fine, firm, youthful figure. Desirable is the word, Mr. Regan. Desirable. You understand what I mean?
You make it pretty clear. So, that brings us to the anonymous packages.
For almost 6 weeks, someone has been sending Mary gifts. Almost every day. Flowers, candy, novelties, that sort of thing. No name. No indication where they come from.
Mary has no idea either?
No. But she's reacted to them badly. They're making her nervous, upset. There's something I can't afford to have happen.
Come again?
Mr. Regan, I can observe that there's little use in trying to keep anything back from you. My interest in the package matter is because of money.
Now the story begins to make sense.
Mary is strange. Perhaps I should have said peculiar. Her aversion to men is almost, well, I've been sending her to a Mr. Farthing, a human relations counselor.
A psychologist?
Something like that.
And it costs money.
Yes, it costs money. The more delay in cure, the more it costs. Frankly, Mr. Regan, I'm tired of the obligation.
She work?
Yes. She works at one of those drive-in stands, Carhop.
Something wrong with that?
The place is called Hamburger Heaven, Mr. Regan.
And you want me to find the guy who sends the packages so he'll marry her, or so you can get rid of him?
It works the same either way. You'll take the job, Mr. Regan?
Sure. I'll find your guy. Maybe he'll look good under your Christmas tree. Ward Hamilton gave me the girl's address in Hollywood. It was a tired stucco four flat just off Kingsley, the home of Mary Winter, the girl who hated men. And then it was too easy. Standing out front near the curb was a little man in a trench coat. He carried an umbrella over his arm and he paced up and down watching the apartment. That was too good a bet to pass up. You going somewhere?
I beg your pardon?
Someone you know lives in there?
Why, that's none of your business, sir.
The name of the friend wouldn't be Mary Winter.
Get out of my way.
That's what I thought. Hold it.
Let go of my arm. Let go, I say.
Why are you watching Mary Winter's apartment?
I warn you, let go. Let
answer
go.
Me.
Very well. I'll answer you.
The umbrella in his hand came down on my wrist and he broke for the corner. By the time I turned, he was out of sight. On the ground, broken, was the little man's umbrella. I picked it up. Real break. Name engraved on the handle. In nice big gold letters, it said, Smith. I headed for Mary Winter's apartment. I knocked and nothing happened. Knocked again. The radio in the room told me somebody was in and liked their music loud. I tried the door and it worked. I stuck my head in to look around. A redhead came in from another room in slacks and halter. She saw me. She dived for the closet and came out wearing a coat. Then she snapped off the radio.
Get out of here!
Look, I tried knocking, but...
Get out before I call the police!
The name's Regan. Ward Hamilton sent me.
You're lying. You're trying to trick me.
Phone him. He'll tell you.
What do you want?
About the presents you've been getting. Tell me.
I'm not sure. I can't trust you.
Look, for the last time, I'm supposed to find out who's sending them. Either you help or you don't. Now, take your choice.
All right. I'll listen. But don't you come a step closer.
I sat down, one corner of the room. Redhead, other corner. She was tall, graceful, beautiful. Everything a guy could want. Except for the look in her eyes. Scared, hunted. I waited for her to start it.
They began several weeks ago. The presents. I don't know who is sending them or why, but I...
Any card? Identification?
No, nothing.
You sure?
You think I'd accept gifts from a stranger?
Take it easy. Nobody said that. What did Farthing tell you?
Farthing?
The human relations counselor you go to.
Oh, you know about that?
Yeah, I know about that. What did he say?
That I shouldn't worry. That I should find out.
That all?
Oh, you don't understand. You're like all of them. Get out of here!
One question.
You know a little guy, about 30, carries an umbrella, wears a trench coat, shy?
No, no!
Are you sure? Think. A little guy.
No, no, I don't know him. I've never met him in my life. Get out!
I left the redhead sobbing softly to herself. Maybe a lot of flowers and candy would be kind of nice to a lot of people during Christmas, but not to Mary Winter. She was mixed up, inside and out. I headed back to my car, and then I was mixed up. It had looked easy until I got to my car. That's when I got complications. A big complication. Fat, 40, with a gun.
Get in, Shamus.
Now what?
Your choice, Shamus.
Like what?
The Winter Dame,
Your property?
Not my type.
Belong to the boss?
Question, Shamus,
Beat it, will you?
I'm not through with you.
Okay, get through.
Stay away from Mary Winter or you get trouble. Real bad trouble. Any questions now, Shamus?
Yeah. Who pays you?
You shouldn't have asked that question.
It looked like it was going to be a real holiday season. Brotherly love all over the place. The next stop was a man named Mr. Farthing. Only the sign on the door said John J. Farthing, Human Relations Counselor. It was a plush layout. Waiting room the size of a box top. Rich, solid, lined with deep green leather chairs, brass studs. On the wall, Van Gogh, Gauguin, that kind of stuff. The receptionist was out, and I took a crack at the thick mahogany door.
Yes, come in, please.
What may I do for you, sir?
The name's Regan, international detective.
Oh, sit down, Mr. Regan. Now, is something troubling you?
Girl named Winter, Mary Winter.
Go on, Mr. Regan.
She's a patient of yours?
Why do you ask?
A couple of questions about her.
I see.
Since you know her background, I thought you could fill me in on a few things. I said
I heard you, Mr. Regan.
Well?
Perhaps, sir, you're aware of the nature of my work. Since I assume you're an intelligent man, I don't believe it's necessary to be much more explicit than that.
Try it for size.
Very well. Cigarette, Mr. Regan?
Thanks.
There is in existence a code of ethics. Some practitioners call it the Hippocratic Oath. I'm not a doctor, as you know, yet I too, Mr. Regan, have a moral code.
I'm listening.
Nothing in my code, either morally, ethically, or in any other way, allows me to discuss the affairs of my patients. Is that clear?
Yeah. That's clear.
I'm sorry I can't assist you in whatever it is you're trying to do, Mr. Regan. I'd like to help, but as you see, my hands are tied.
That makes two of us. Thanks. Thanks a lot. Mr. Farthing, gray suit, ivory cigarette holder, and gold cufflinks, stood up and shook hands solemnly. I left. He'd given me nothing. And there was only one thing wrong with that. Mr. Farthing was right. I decided to check in with my boss, Anthony J. Lyon.
International Detective Agency, Anthony...
Save it for the customers, Fatso.
Jeffrey, where have you been?
Look, I just started this business 2 hours ago. What's eating you?
Just this. I have here in my office with me a young man. He has an interesting story, Jeffrey. It seems he's been sending gifts to one Mary Winter.
What?
That's correct, Regan, the man you're supposed to be looking for. Well, don't just stand there. Get over here at once. This young man can't wait all day for lazy detectives. And besides, he needs help.
He needs help?
Yeah, that's right, Jeffrey. The man you were supposed to find. His life's in danger.
This is CBS, and you're listening to Jeff Regan, Investigator, in tonight's adventure, Some Enchanted Carhop.
It started when a guy named Ward Hamilton hired the Lion and me to find out who was sending packages to a car hop named Mary Winter. I met a little guy with an umbrella and a big guy with a gun. and a human relations counselor who called himself Mr. Farthing. Then I phoned my boss, Anthony J. Lyon, and found the mysterious Santa Claus who'd been sending the girl gifts had walked right into our office. When I got there, I found the Lyon sitting with his fingertips touching as he talked to the man across the desk from him. Like I guessed, it was the same guy I'd seen outside Mary Winter's apartment. The little guy. 30, trench coat, and nervous.
Jeffrey, come in. I want you to meet our new client, Mr. Smith. Mr. Ernest Smith. He's in trouble.
Well, if he isn't, he should be.
Jeffrey, what on earth do you mean?
I found your Mr. Smith outside the girl's apartment. He wasn't looking for frost on those windows.
No, Mr. Regan. That's...
What Mr. Smith is trying to say, Jeffrey, is that that's not true. Mr. Smith is in real trouble.
You sell it to him?
Jeffrey, how can you say such a thing? Mr. Smith feels his life is in danger, hence he has retained us to act in his behalf.
That's true, Mr. Regan. I'll admit I sent the gifts to Miss Winter. I didn't know...
Get to the point.
Now I'm afraid. Since I saw you this afternoon, someone's following me.
Fat guy, big coat.
Yes. I came here for help. Someone doesn't like my sending the gifts.
Well, that's real bright. Well, you can start with Mary Winter.
She doesn't like them, Mr. Regan?
Then there's a guy named Hamilton.
She's married?
We call him a guardian, family friend.
Oh.
Finish your story.
I like Miss Winter. I wanted to do something for her.
So you've been sending her anonymous presents for almost 6 weeks. Isn't that carrying the Christmas spirit too far?
Well, I like her. That's not abnormal, is it, Mr. Regan?
Yeah, of course not, Mr. Smith.
You keep out of this, Fatso.
Yeah, but Jeffrey, our client...
We got another client named Hamilton, remember? Besides, you haven't met the girl.
Neither have I.
What?
I've never met Mary Winter. Is that abnormal, Mr. Regan? Oh, dear. Dear, perhaps I'm sicker than Mr. Farthing told me.
Say that again.
Mr. Farthing, my human relations counselor, he takes care of me.
Oh, wait a minute. Maybe this is going to add up. You've never met Mary Winter?
No.
No, but you've seen her. You've seen her in the waiting room of Farthing's office.
Why, Mr. Regan, how on earth did you guess? That's exactly it. She was reading a copy of Reader's Digest, and I was reading an old National Geographic. It was a fall...
Never mind. Well, Lyon, I think that wraps that up.
Jeffrey, what do you mean?
Mary Winter is afraid of unknown guy sending packages. Unknown guy turns out to be Smith. Take Smith to Mary, show her he's harmless. Collect our fees.
But, Jeffrey, what about Mr. Smith? What about the man who's following him?
Maybe he just imagined it. Come on, Smith. We're going to visit a redhead. The Lyon didn't believe Smith imagined it any more than I did. But he only sputtered, and I loaded Smith into the car and headed out to Mary Winter's apartment. It looked simple. Then, like a glass of mild eggnog. What I didn't know was that somebody had slipped me a zombie. It was turning dark when we pulled up in front of the place. Smith stayed at my heels like a sheepdog. I knocked. This time, she opened the door.
Oh, Mr. Regan, what are you doing here?
Brought your Christmas present. Only this one's harmless.
Oh, no.
Take it easy, sweetheart. Just a guy named Smith. You might even like him.
No, please go away. Please go away.
Smith and I walked on in, and Mary backed into a chair in the far corner of the room. She and Smith looked at each other and didn't say anything, so I waited for the sparks to die out of her eyes. But they didn't. There was something else on her mind.
This is the man who sent the packages.
You guessed it. Smith, Mary Winter. Mary Winter, Smith.
Get him out of here!
Huh?
I said get him out of here before he kills me! Oh, no.
Sit down. Now, just a minute, lady. He won't hurt anybody. Just take it easy, will you? Just take quiet.
That's what you're saying. Oh, no, I
now, listen, sweetheart. Wait a minute. It's Christmas. You've heard of that, I think, haven't you? People send presents to each other because it makes them feel good. Now, Smith sent you presents for the same reason.
He's going to kill me. You're like he is, trying to trap me.
Oh, that does it.
All right. Look at this.
What, a card?
It came in a box of flowers. It was delivered here to my apartment tonight.
Each man kills the thing he loves.
Well, Regan, try and explain that. Try and...
Shut up. Did you send this, Smith?
No, Mr. Regan. I didn't send it. I sent flowers and candy and nice things.
Mr. Regan, at the window!
I left them with their mouths open and ran for the hall, and then outside. The girl may have had an overworked imagination, but her mind didn't knock over that garbage can. dark and peaceful and still outside. Me and a half moon and nobody else. And then I saw him, thick-set, crouched, moving away from the window. I dove after him. We went down together as his hand came out of his pocket. The heavy gray .45 got itself in my direction, and I grabbed at the wrist behind him. The gun fell into the rose bush, but he got to his feet.
I warned you once, Shamus. Stay away from that girl.
Who said so?
Never mind. Now, get off the chase now, before it's too late. It'll only mean... No!
Were you going to say... Trouble? The big guy was 200 pounds of unconscious as I bent over him. A heavy camel hair coat was wrapped around him. The same guy I'd seen before. I unbuttoned the coat, figuring some identification might help, only when it came open, I didn't need any more. He was wearing a tailored starched jacket. It wasn't the kind you see every day. It was white. That gave me the lead I needed, and I headed fast for my car. 10 minutes later, I stopped at the drugstore on my way out to the valley. I phoned the Lion and told him to check on Farthing. Then I headed the car out Cahuenga. The pass was crowded with home-from-work traffic. It took me 25 minutes to make Iredell Road and the home of Ward Hamilton. This time, the Dalmatian was out for the night. But Ward Hamilton wasn't. He opened the door.
Well, well, Mr. Regan, come in. You work late.
A time clock's out of order.
Oh, perhaps you'd like one for Christmas.
No, thanks. Wouldn't fit in my sock.
Well, Mr. Regan, I take it by this visit that you have good news for me.
Call it that.
You know who's been sending the girl those gifts?
A guy named Smith.
How's that again?
Smith, Ernest Smith, his birth certificate says.
I'm afraid I've never heard of him, Mr. Regan.
He saw Mary in the waiting room of Farthing's office. Never met her. Shy little guy.
Well, now isn't that something? And I must say, Mr. Regan, you did a remarkably fast job.
There's something else you ought to know, Hamilton. Chances are Farthing's a phony.
Mr. Farthing?
Looks like.
Why, it seems absurd.
Just thought I'd let you know. Want me to go on with the case?
What do you mean, Mr. Regan?
I found your guy, Smith. That's what you hired me for. And when I get to Farthing, he'll sing like a prima donna.
He'll sing?
Talk.
Well, then keep going.
Okay, Hamilton. It's your money.
It's your life, Mr. Regan. Be careful.
I made a fast phone call to the Lion on my way back into town, and that tied it up. Farthing was working late when I got there, only when he looked up and saw me, he wasn't happy.
What do you want?
Conversation. A lot of it.
Mr. Regan... I must ask why you've come to my office at this hour.
I told you, for conversation.
Then I may regard this whole thing as a sort of joke?
Maybe. Only the laughs you'll get wouldn't get by even on television.
I demand an explanation of your attitude.
Fair enough. Start with your name. Not Farthing, it's Farnham, Howard Farnham.
Hmm?
You want more?
Where did you get that?
I had a phone conversation with my boss. He's got ways of getting things. Like your record. 5 arrest bunco, 1 arrest forgery, 1 arrest fraud.
No conviction.
You were lucky. Maybe you won't be this time.
You haven't got anything on me, Regan?
How about blackmail?
Not a chance.
Maybe not yet. Only you were getting set for a job. I believe the guy's name was Hamilton.
You can't prove it.
Well, it was your mug, the big guy in the white jacket. He meant business. Does he do your legwork?
Listen, Regan, you can't pin blackmail on me. Sure, maybe I had ideas, but I don't claim I'm a doctor. I don't hand out any pills. Just advice, Regan. That's all. Just advice.
That's too bad. You know, there are a lot of people that take phonies like you seriously, Farnham. A lot of people that could use advice. Real advice.
Mine's real. They say, should I marry him? And I say, yes or no, depending...
On how much there is in it for you.
What do you want from me, Regan?
Who paid you to put the B on Mary Winter?
Never mind, Farthing. You won't have to answer that.
Come on in, Hamilton. I've been waiting for you.
You're bragging, Mr. Regan.
It made sense if I could get you to join Farthing and me. You might have something to say. You're showing up. Check my story.
What story?
Like this. Man named Hamilton's supposed to look out for a young redhead named Mary Winter. Only Hamilton takes one look at this number and suddenly he's not fatherly anymore. He decides to move in for himself.
It's absurd.
Is it? You convinced the girl she couldn't trust any man in the world but you. Should have been the other way around. You're the one she couldn't trust. Isn't that right, Farthing?
Leave me out of this, Regan. I run a legitimate business.
Leave you out? Well, that wouldn't be fair.
You were the guy Hamilton came to with money. He paid you to tell Mary Winter who was the man for her. Am I right, Farthing?
You're lying, Regan.
No. No, I'm not. Everything worked fine until along came a nice, shy little guy with an umbrella, Mr. Smith. Met Mary in Farthing's waiting room, starting sending her presents. You know, that must have really stopped you, Hamilton, trying to figure out who was cutting in on your Romeo act.
Regan, I've had enough out of you. I thought you were getting nosy.
You hired me to find the guy, and I did. End of story. Except if anybody should happen to tell Mary Winter what kind of a guy you really are, Hamilton, you might suddenly find yourself out of a lifetime career.
You'll never tell her, Regan. I'll see to that.
Forget one item. For a last touch, you send Mary a threatening note. Really put the pressure on. You're washed up, Hamilton.
This revolver says I'm not, Mr. Regan. Well, then, come over here out of the way. We're going to take care of Mr. Regan.
Self-defense, not a chance with Farthing's record. Am I right, Farnham?
Do as I say, Farthing.
Go ahead, Farnham. Go ahead. Murder will look good on your list.
I won't play ball, Hamilton. I told the girl what you wanted, but I'm not in this. It's your fight.
I can make it yours.
Don't try it.
I am as good with this gun, gentlemen, as I am with a whip. Farnham, watch out.
Farnham ducked as I hit Hamilton's wrist. The bullet buried itself in the desktop and the gun hit the floor. I got the gun as Hamilton moved in fast. Only what he got for his trouble was the barrel across his head. Farnham called up to his chair and sat down, puffing. I let him catch his breath. When I waved the gun in his direction, he didn't mind phoning the police. The heavy guy in the white jacket showed up bright and early for work the next morning, and the cop greeted him with a pair of handcuffs. He got off with assault and battery, and Farnham, alias Farthing, made the blotter for a light charge. Hamilton wasn't that lucky. His read assault with intent to kill. It was noon when I got to the lion's office. He was admiring the Christmas tree stuck in the corner. And from the sounds that came out of his mouth, it looked like his holiday fever was becoming serious.
Born is a king of... Oh, hello, Jeffrey.
They're looking for a replacement for Vaughn Monroe?
Jeffrey, how unkind. It's the season for songs. Sunday is Christmas, my boy.
And today is payday.
so it is. Well, perhaps I could manage a small token, a sign of my gratitude.
Thanks.
Yeah, by the way, what about Mary Winter, the car hop? How is the girl, Jeffrey?
Oh, I left her with Smith last night when I went after Farthing's mug.
Jeffrey, you didn't. Alone together? And that girl hating all men and that boy shy, backwards? Jeffrey, how could you? How cruel.
It's too late now, Lion. Maybe we'll read about it in the afternoon paper.
Double murder.
Double hamburger.
What did you say?
I drove by Mary's drive-in this morning. There was a car parked there.
Jeffrey... You mean...
Little guy behind the wheel. Trench coat, umbrella. He looked an awful lot like our boy Smith.
And then you talked to them?
For a minute.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Tell me, Jeffrey, tell me. What did Mary say?
She said, with or without onions? Merry Christmas, Lion.
Merry Christmas, Jeffrey.
Jeff Regan, Investigator, is written by William Frug and William Fifield, produced by Sterling Tracy, directed by Gordon T. Hughes, and stars Frank Graham as Regan with Frank Nelson as Anthony J. Lyon. Original music is by Dick Arant. Jeff Regan, Investigator, is heard each week at the same time over CBS. Bob Stevenson speaking and inviting you to be with us again next week at this same time for Jeff Regan, Investigator. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Change to protect the innocent.
Fatima Cigarettes, best of all long cigarettes, brings you Dragnet. You're a detective sergeant. You're assigned to burglary detail. Unidentified thieves start a campaign of burglaries in your city. Homes are broken into and stripped of their furnishings. There's no lead on the criminals. Your job, get them. When you compare Fatima with other long cigarettes, the difference is quality.
Yes, in Fatima, the difference is quality. If you want a long cigarette, smoke that best of all long cigarettes. Smoke extra mild Fatima. Fatima is the quality king-size cigarette because it contains the finest Turkish and domestic tobaccos, superbly blended. And Fatima is extra mild, with a much different, much better flavor and aroma than any other long cigarette. Because of its quality, its extra mildness, its better flavor and aroma, Fatima has more than doubled its smokers coast to coast. Enjoy extra mild Fatima yourself.
It's wise to smoke extra mild Fatima.
Because in Fatima, the difference is quality.
Yes, in Fatima, the difference is quality.
Smoke Fatima, the quality king-size cigarette. Best of all, long cigarettes.
Dragnet, the documented drama of an actual crime. For the next 30 minutes, in cooperation with the Los Angeles Police Department, you will travel step by step on the side of the law through an actual case from official police files. From beginning to end, from crime to punishment, Dragnet is the story of your police force in action.
It was Monday, August 3rd. It was warm in Los Angeles. We were working the day watch out of burglary detail. My partner's Ben Romero. The boss is Thad Brown, chief of detectives. My name's Friday. I was on the way back from the business office, and it was 9:25 a.m. when I got to room 45, burglary detail.
Did they get all the money together, Joe?
Yeah, a dollar from each man in the detail. We got to buy the gift.
When's Austin going to get married?
Next Sunday. We haven't got too much time.
I don't know why we always have to pick out the gift.
Somebody has to do it. You got any ideas what we ought to get him?
Talked to my wife over the weekend. She thinks it'd be nice if we get him something to start housekeeping with. Maybe some nice kitchenware, table lamp.
Yeah, I don't know if we have enough dough for a good lamp. But maybe they might like a bedspread. You can always use them. Or maybe a nice wool blanket, huh?
I don't know. Got to be careful about those personal things.
What do you mean? What's personal about a blanket?
Well, we don't know much about the girl Austin's going to marry. She might not need any.
Excuse me. Could you tell me something?
What's that?
Could you tell me something?
Well, what do you want to know, little girl?
Is this where you come to report about stolen things?
Well, no, that all depends. Why don't you come on in and tell us all about it, huh?
Thank you, I will.
Like to sit down, little girl?
I'm 12 years old. I'll stand if it's all right.
All right. Now, would you like to tell us what's been stolen?
Everything.
Hmm?
Everything's been stolen. We came back this morning and found it that way. Grandpa's awful mad.
Mm-hmm. Maybe we better get the facts to start with. What's your name?
Ruth Emery Jeanette.
Jeanette? Is that your last name?
No, Snyder. Ruth Emery Jeanette Snyder.
Did you come down here alone, Ruth?
Yes, Grandpa sent me. He's awful mad.
Where do you live?
With Grandpa.
Where's that?
Over on College Avenue. Grandpa's leg's bothering him. Arthritis. So he told me to come down and tell you about it.
About what, ma'am?
Everything. We came back this morning on the train, and when we got home, we found everything was stolen. It's terrible.
What do you mean by everything?
I walked all the way over here to tell you. I'm thirsty, sir. Drinking fountain in the hall.
Well, we've got a cooler over here. Let me get you a cup, huh?
Thank you.
You like a drink, ma'am?
Oh, no, thanks.
Lady, here you are.
Thank you very much.
Now, would you like to tell us what it's all about?
Well, Grandpa and I got back to Los Angeles on the train this morning. We've been on a trip back to Indiana.
Uh-huh.
We took a taxi cab home from the station. When we got there, everything was gone. Everything but the rug in the dining room.
Yeah?
All the furniture, every single bit. The sofa, the chairs, my desk upstairs, the stove. Everything's been stolen. I want you to find it.
You mean someone broke in while you were gone and took all your furniture? Is that what you think?
You know they did. The lock on the back door, it was broken. They took everything but the dining room rug. That's why Grandpa's home now.
Hmm?
He thinks the crooks will be back. He's sitting on the rug because he says if they take that, they'll have to take him too. We better hurry.
Yeah?
Grandpa's not very big.
A.M. Ben and I drove little Ruth Ann Snyder back to her home on College Avenue. It was an old-fashioned wooden frame structure a few doors up from College Avenue and Everett Way. Ruth Ann showed us inside and introduced us to her grandfather, Mr. John H. Snyder, age 78. He told us that a year ago, he and his wife, Ruth Ann's grandmother, had come to California from Indiana and rented the house on College Avenue. The grandmother had fallen ill and passed away suddenly 3 weeks ago. He and Ruth Ann closed the house and took the body back to Indiana on the train for burial. On their return that morning, they found the house stripped of every piece of furniture. We checked room by room and listed the missing articles. We put in a call to latent fingerprints.
Do you happen to know the serial numbers of your home appliances, Mr. Snyder?
No, sir. I've lived with most of the furniture for 40 years. You get to know the things you own in 40 years.
I know what was in my room, Sergeant. My desk, my table and chair, the bed, the curtains. They took everything.
Well, how about the estimated value of the furniture, sir? What would you say it was worth?
Dollars and cents? Oh, I don't know. What's a house full of furniture worth to anyone? Guess everybody puts their own value on their things.
Yes, sir, they do.
Solid walnut dining set. A wedding present. Mahogany front room table. A solid, too. Cost money in their day. All gone.
Were there any liens against the furniture, sir?
How's that?
Did you owe anything on the furniture? I mean, there was no trouble with the finance company or anything like that.
Oh, we didn't even know what a finance company was when the wife and I was married. It was sad enough, Chip, as it was. And Ruthie and me get here this morning, and everything's gone. All we own. Ruthie.
Yes, Grandpa.
Where the thieves broke in. Would you show the officers, please?
It's back this way.
Okay. How are you and your grandfather going to make out here, Ruth?
Well, Grandpa says we'll buy 2 cots for tonight, army surplus. There's no stove to cook on. We'll have to eat out.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we'll have to go back to Indiana. Grandpa doesn't have much money. He's on a pension. Here's the back door. Let's see what they get to get in.
Mm-hmm.
Must have used a hammer and a crowbar. Smashed it clean through.
You'll find the crooks, won't you, Sergeant?
We're going to try, Ruth. Better have the crime lab check this, huh?
Yeah. How about your neighbors, Ruth? You know any of them well?
I know who they are. I don't know any of them good. They're not very friendly.
We'd like to ask you and your grandfather a few more questions, Ruth.
All right. I don't know what I'm going to do when school starts. They stole all my stuff, even my composition tablets. I'm going to have to take those.
Which grade are you in, Ruthie?
I was in A7. I'll be in the B8. Why did they take my school things?
I don't know.
You see how they got in back there?
Yes, sir, we did. By any chance, did any of your neighbors know that you and Ruth here were going away?
Well, I didn't mention it, no.
Then no one kept an eye on your house while you were gone?
No, I didn't think it was necessary.
Might have helped.
I just remembered, Grandpa. Mrs. Merton. I told her we were going away.
Who's that, Ruth?
She runs a store down at the corner of the bird store. Yeah. She sells canaries, other kinds of birds, too. Mrs. Merton's her name. Store's right down the corner.
You figure she's the only one who knew you'd be gone from the house for some time.
Must have been the only one.
All right, Mr. Snyder, we'll be back to see you later on. Here's our card. We'll see if we can't do something to help you out here.
Let's see here. Friday... Romero, burglary detail. All right, thank you, boy. Ruthie will show you to the door.
Yes, Grandpa.
I'm listening.
Right. Goodbye, sir.
Oh, say there.
Yes, sir.
Yes, you understand, but I'd like to apologize anyway. I just couldn't do it.
What's that, sir?
Offer you a chair.
A.M. Ben and I called the Salvation Army and told them the Snyder situation. And then we went down the street to the store at the corner of Coolidge Avenue and Everett Way. The sign on the window said Mrs. Merton's Birdland, manager Agnes Merton. We tried the door. It was locked. The cardboard clock hanging on the glass door read, "Be back at 1 p.m. So we went back up to College Avenue and we started ringing doorbells. Some of the residents on the block didn't even know the Snyders. Of those that did, only 2 had noticed any activity at the house during the 3 weeks Mr. Snyder and his granddaughter had been away. They told us that they'd seen a moving van park in front of the house about a week before. They also saw men moving furniture from the house into the van. Neither of the 2 could describe the vehicle or remember its license number. 12:45 p.m. We had a cup of coffee and a hamburger, and then we headed back for Mrs. Merton's bird store.
Can I help you, gentlemen?
Yes, ma'am. Police officers. I have a few questions for you.
About birds?
No, ma'am. About one of your neighbors.
Oh.
The Snyders? They live just up the street from me?
Oh, yes, old couple. Poor Mr. Snyder passed away, you know, a few weeks ago.
Yes, ma'am, we know.
They have a wonderful granddaughter, Ruthie. She and I are getting to be great friends. The Snyders having some kind of trouble?
We're investigating a burglary at their house.
Oh, is that so? Now, you be quiet, Mary. You heard what I told Blackie. Just eat your food and be quiet.
I guess you knew the Snyders had been away for the last few weeks.
Yes, I did, but they're back. I saw Ruthie pass the window this morning.
You noticed any activity around the Snyders' house since they've been gone?
Well, yes, I did.
And just what did you notice, Miss Merton?
Well, it was 7 or 8 days ago, I think. Some white moving truck stopped in front of their place and two men started moving up Snyder's furniture.
Uh-huh.
Thought it was a little strange because Ruthie hadn't told me anything about moving. In fact, she said definitely she and her grandpa were coming back after poor Mrs. Snyder's funeral in Indiana.
Did you investigate it all, ma'am?
Oh, excuse me. Who is that? You, Fred? Yes, you ought to be ashamed. You can see I'm busy. Another outburst like that, and all three of you, Fred, Blackie, Mary, I'll take care of you. Now, where was I?
You saw the moving van in front of the Snyders.
Oh, yes. And I went up to the moving men and asked them if the Snyders were going back to Indiana. Well, of course, they didn't know anything about it.
Did you inquire at the Snyders' house?
Well, no, it so happened I didn't. I was on my way to one of the big aviaries in the valley, and I just didn't have time to stop.
How about the moving van? Did you happen to notice the license?
I don't remember the numbers.
Any identifying marks about the truck you might remember? Maybe a sign on the side?
Yes, the side of the truck was painted white. And there was large blue lettering on it, Denine Story, that said I remember that much.
Is that all?
Well, yes. As I said, I was in a hurry. I had to pick up three sick canaries out in the valley.
Is there anything else about the incident you can remember? Anything at all?
No, I'm afraid not.
Well, thank you very much, Ms. Merton. Here's our card if you happen to come across any further information.
Yes, all right. I'll have to go see the Snyders. Maybe I can help.
Fine. Goodbye, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Yes, goodbye.
Goodbye.
Fred, now you
stop
up this minute. Fred?
Yeah, not much help there.
Not much. Give me an idea, though.
Hmm?
Wedding present for the Austins.
Yeah?
Maybe a couple of canaries? In a nice cage?
Five p.m. We went back to the office. Reports had come in from two more victims. That night, Ben and I drove out to interview them. The circumstances of the theft and the M.O. of the criminals matched identically with the Snyder case. Both of the families victimized had gone off on vacations and neglected to notify either the neighbors or the patrolmen in their area. Both had allowed daily newspapers to collect on their doorsteps in their absence and otherwise left signs that their homes were vacant. In both cases, the thieves had forced an entrance through a back door or window, stripped the house of every last piece of furniture, and either hauled it away themselves or hired somebody to do it for them. We started canvassing the two areas where the crimes had been reported. Again, the neighbors saw the moving vans, but none were able to definitely identify the vehicles or their license numbers. Captain Fulton called us into his office.
You're going to have to try harder. I know they're hard to get, but get them fast.
We've done about everything we can so far, Skipper.
Only one small lead. The thieves seemed to be using a different moving van on each job. We started to check the movers around town, the transfer companies.
Clayton Prince come up with anything yet?
No, no luck there.
One of the lousiest rackets we've had since I came on this detail. Whole house full of the furniture, everything a family owns.
Yeah. Well, we'll stay on top of it. The stats office may come up with something.
How about an outlet for all that stuff that's been stolen? Thieves can't be sitting on it.
Pawn shop and second-hand details have been alerted.
They're checking regular outlets, auction houses, second-hand places, nothing yet.
What about some kind of preventive idea? At least slow them down.
Good dose of publicity on the whole thing would help. If only people wouldn't keep it a secret when they're going away. Neighbors aren't alerted. That's why a lot of them didn't think much of it when they saw the moving vans parked at those houses.
And drawing blinds and the newspapers on the doorsteps didn't help much either. It's an open invitation.
Well, I'll see what we can do on the publicity end. We've had one campaign on this already. No, excuse me. Burglary, Captain Fulton. What's the address? Okay, I got it. Thank you. Here you go, another one.
Hmm?
63R just called it in. Family back from vacation. Furniture all gone. Here's the address here.
Thank you.
Better get on it right away.
Let's go.
I'll have a little more help for you on this tomorrow. Crowley and Barnes will be free. They can work with you.
Okay, Skipper. We'll check you later.
All right.
Sergeant Friday?
Oh, yes,
you remember me, don't you, Mrs. Merton?
Oh, sure. The bird store. Yes, ma'am. How are you?
Well, they told me to wait here. I guess everything will be all right now.
Yeah?
I saw it today on Olive Street. Here.
Hmm?
The truck that came to Snyder's house. That's the license number.
You are listening to Dragnet, the case history of a police investigation presented in the public interest by Fatima Cigarettes.
It's amazing how many long cigarette smokers are changing to extra mild Fatima. Here is the actual report.
From coast to coast, Fatima has more than doubled its smokers.
Here is the reason why. When you compare Fatima with other long cigarettes, the difference is quality.
Yes, in Fatima, the difference is quality. Fatima is the quality king-size cigarette because it contains the finest Turkish and domestic tobaccos, superbly blended. And Fatima is extra mild, with a much different, much better flavor and aroma than any other long cigarette.
And because of its quality, its extra mildness, its better flavor and aroma, more and more smokers say it's wise to smoke extra mild Fatima.
I agree, says Dick Hyland, sports columnist.
I agree, says Mrs. Deems Taylor, painter and theatrical designer.
I agree, says Frank Fenton, author.
Yes, all agree. It's wise to smoke extra mild Fatima, best of all long cigarettes.
Because in Fatima, the difference is quality.
Yes, in Fatima, the difference is quality.
Smoke Fatima, the quality king-size cigarette.
Tuesday, August 11th, 6 p.m. The license number, which Mrs. Merton had given us, was checked through DMV. We found that the truck was registered in the name of a local secondhand furniture dealer by the name of Ralph Grismore. We checked his name through the police commission and then the I Bureau. He had a good reputation, no criminal record. Early the next morning, we picked up Mr. Snyder and his granddaughter, Ruth, and we drove to Grismore's secondhand furniture store. We identified ourselves and asked to look at his buy book. Under the date of July 27th, Grismore had recorded the purchase of more than 36 articles of furniture from a house on College Avenue. The address was that of the Snyders.
A man and a woman, Sergeant, they said they'd sold their house and they're going east. Man said the company he worked for transferred him to Boston. Told me he had to get back to take over his new job.
Would you recognize the people if you saw them again, Grismore?
Sure, I think so. The woman is a great talker. She said they figured on selling the stuff piece by piece. They'd get more, but since they had to leave town the next day, she decided to sell the whole lot to a dealer.
You got the furniture for a pretty low price, didn't you?
Pretty good price, yeah. That's why I went along in the fast deal. Wasn't going to talk myself out of a bargain. They wanted to sell fast, I wanted to buy. I didn't think anything was wrong.
Sergeant?
Yeah, Mrs. Snyder?
Our walnut dining room set. That's it right over there.
You sure, Mr. Snyder?
Cigar burn on top, just above one of the legs. Know it anywhere. Seems to me that's our mahogany table. I'll look.
Sergeant? My table and my desk, here they are right here. My school stuff, too.
All right, Ruthie.
Yeah, they sure stuck me, all right. That's the last fast deal I ever make.
How did they contact you, Grismore? What kind of approach did they use?
Called me on the phone, and I came out and gave them an appraisal on the stuff. Nothing suspicious about either the man or the woman.
That's so?
She was in a house dress, bandana around her head. The guy was in old clothes, just as homey as you please. Looked like he was doing a little repair work around the house, you know.
Mm-hmm. You notice if they had a car parked by the house?
No, matter of fact, I didn't. There wasn't any in the driveway.
Mm-hmm. No argument over the price you offered them for the furniture?
No. They seemed to hesitate a little, but they took my first offer. I thought I had a good deal. No.
How'd they react after you agreed on a price? In a hurry?
Said they had to board the train that night for Boston. They asked me to get the furniture out right away.
Mm-hmm.
The woman said they had other business to wind up, so if they weren't at the house when I came back with the van, why, she'd leave the back door open for me.
I guess you realized you were going to have to place a hold on this furniture that you bought.
Yeah, I know. I got no one to blame but myself.
And you gave this man and woman a check for the full amount of the sale. Is that right, Grismore?
$550 down the drain.
Do you have the cancel check?
No, not yet. If you like, you can probably get it from the bank. Don't imagine those crooks would waste any time cashing.
Mm-hmm. We'd appreciate it if you'd run down to the bank with us now.
Okay, sir.
Sergeant, could I speak with Mr. Grismore?
Sure, Mr. Snyder.
Mr. Grismore.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry about all this. I didn't know.
Oh, I understand, sir. You buy furniture, don't you?
Yes, sir.
What could you give me for two army surplus cots?
Grismore made arrangements to round up Mr. Snyder's furniture and ship it back to his home. Then we took him down to his bank where he recovered the canceled check for $550. The endorsement read, Mr. Thomas Butterworth. According to the bank teller who waited on them, the suspects had cashed the check shortly after the sale of the Snyder's furniture. From the second-hand dealer and the clerk at the bank, we got a complete description of the man and woman known as Mr. and Mrs. Butterworth. We also had photostatic copies made of the check and specimens of the handwriting from the endorsement. From the descriptions, we checked the suspects through the stats office. We got nowhere. During the next 2 weeks, we found six more second-hand dealers who had been taken in on the same furniture deal. The description of the man and woman matched, and so did the handwriting and the endorsements on each check. There was only one variation. The couple went under a different name on each occasion. Wednesday, August 26th, 9 a.m.
12 cases like this today, then, right?
That's it, Captain. Got the description, M.O. handwriting. Still can't reach him.
Those thieves have been freewheeling for a month now. What's going to take to stop them?
Well, Ben came up with a pretty good idea this morning. He'd like to talk it over with you.
Well, what's that?
Kind of a system of decoy, Skipper. We were thinking it might be a good idea to contact all the division captains and have them ask their men if they have any neighbors going on vacation.
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, if we got a few dozen houses spotted around the city, we could plant a few things. Make them look obviously vacant.
We'd keep the houses covered at all times. They ought to make pretty good bait for those thieves.
Uh-huh. How would you set it up?
We could make arrangements to get a key to each home, keep the milk and paper deliveries coming, let them pile up on the doorstep. We could reimburse the people for whatever it costs.
We're not making any headway. We could run this for a couple of weeks, see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think?
Try it.
9:30 a.m. We contacted all division commanders, requesting them to ask their men to contact burglary detail if they knew of any of their neighbors about to leave on a vacation. During the next 2 days, the response came in and the plan went into effect. 40 homes throughout the city were spotted as decoys. They were kept under surveillance at all times. In the week that followed, two more burglaries of the same type were reported, but the suspects failed to try any of the decoy homes. The men in the pawn shop and secondhand details continued to work right along with us. The stolen furniture kept turning up, but not the thieves. Again, the homes that had been broken into displayed all the usual signs that the occupants were away. Old circulars and newspapers scattered on the lawn. Milk bottles lined up at the door, all the blinds drawn. The decoy plan continued. No results. August 31st, we had a report of another burglary involving the theft of furniture. We made our investigation. 2 p.m., we went back to the office to get out a list of stolen articles.
Hi, Ben.
Joe?
Hi, Austin. When'd you get back from your honeymoon?
Late last night. Say, Thelma and I'd sure like to thank all you fellas for that wedding present you sent us. Darn nice of you.
Well, we're glad you liked it, Austin.
Sure a beauty. I'd like to ask you a question about it, though. I hope you won't take it wrong.
No, go ahead.
Well, what is it?
You've got an early American house, haven't you?
Yeah, that's right.
It's an antique.
Yeah?
It's an apple peeler. One of the first ever built.
Oh, sure. Thanks a lot.
I get it. Burglary Friday. Yeah? Where? Right away, thanks. One of the decoy houses.
Yeah?
We got a bike. Together with Sergeants Crowley and Austin, we drove out to the decoy house where an unidentified man and a woman had been seen forcing entry through a back door. They'd been spotted by a police officer's wife who lived next door and who had called in the report. We parked down the street from the decoy home and waited. 5 minutes passed. We saw a woman dressed in a house coat come out onto the porch of the house, look up and down the street, and then go back inside. A few minutes after that, a gray Chevrolet sedan pulled up in front of the house. A man in a dark suit got out and entered through the front door. Ben called communications for a make on the car.
80K to control 4. 80K to control 4. Request DMV on 6 Mary 6778. Repeat 6M 6778. Information urgent.
Roger, 80K. AMA 6778.
We waited. There were no signs of activity from the decoy house. 2 minutes after Ben put in the call, we got our make on the gray sedan.
Control 4 to 80K.
80K, go ahead.
6 Mary 6778. 6M6778 is registered to the Donahoe Furniture Company. Legal the same. 7811 Harvard Boulevard. It is a Chevrolet Deluxe, two-door sedan, 1941 model. Engine number C6VA4414.
80K, Roger. KMA367.
A few minutes after the call back, a moving van drove down the street and backed into the driveway of the decoy house. The sign on the side of the van read Donahoe Furniture Company. Two men got out, went up to the front door, and were let in. They came out in a couple of minutes and loaded a sofa into the moving van.
Okay, Joe.
Charlie and Austin get the sign.
Yeah, here they come.
Well, let's go. Hey, you and Crowley want to cover the back, Austin?
Right. Let's go, Crowley.
Yeah. Come on, Ben.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir. You want something?
Police officers like...
Calling the cops! Run him!
Stand still, you.
Austin and Crowley got her.
All right, hold still, mister.
Hey, what's this all about, you cops?
That's right. You?
Max Donahoe. I'm buying this lot of furniture. Something the matter?
You're buying from the wrong people. They're not the owners. You better have your men move that stuff back in the house.
Okay, if you say so.
All right, lady, relax.
Take it easy, Helen. There's no use fighting. They got us.
Whose fault is it? I told you luck doesn't last forever.
Okay, all right. Don't make it worse.
All right, let's go.
I'll take her, Austin. You better fix your shirt.
Yeah.
Come on, lady.
Put your hands on me.
Hey, what's the matter with your shirt, Austin?
Look. It must have happened when she tried to get away.
Yeah, lipstick all over the collar there.
Doesn't look very good.
No, it doesn't. What are you going to tell your new bride?
I got nothing to hide. I'll tell her the truth.
Yeah?
She'll believe me. Won't she?
The story you've just heard was true. Only the names were changed to protect the innocent.
On November 25th, trial was held in Superior Court, Department 87, City and County of Los Angeles, State of California. In a moment, the results of that trial.
And now, here is our star, Jack Webb.
Thank you. Under our system of law, the jury selected to hear a case is accorded complete freedom. The jury's decision is the final result of the testimony and evidence presented in the course of the trial. So, with Fatima, they are the final result of carefully selecting and blending only the finest Turkish and domestic tobaccos to make Fatima extra mild. If you're a long cigarette smoker like I am, buy a pack of Fatimas and compare them with other long cigarettes, and you'll see the difference is quality. Yes, in Fatima, the difference is quality. So, smoke Fatima.
The suspects were identified as Mr. and Mrs. Thomas Dunbar. They were arraigned on 15 counts of burglary and tried and found guilty on all counts. They are now serving their terms in the state penitentiary. You have just heard Dragnet, a series of authentic cases from official files. Technical advice came from the Office of Chief of Police W.H. Parker, Los Angeles Police Department.
Fatima Cigarettes, the best of all long cigarettes, has brought you Dragnet from Los Angeles.
Coming up, Duffy's Tavern. Bob Hope returns October 3rd on NBC.
Ladies and gentlemen, the American Broadcasting Company brings to its entire network one of radio's most unusual programs, Pat Novak for Hire.
Sure. I'm Pat Novak for hire.
That's what the sign out in front of my office says. Pat Novak for hire. If you're trying to make a living down on the waterfront in San Francisco, you got to run things like a smorgasbord. You take a little of everything you can get your hands on. Even then, it's a bumpy ride, because down here, everybody tries to pad his part. Oh, I rent boats and do anything else good men pay bad men to do. You don't get many gold stars that way, but you pay the bar bill, and it's about as safe as a closet full of tigers. The only way you can make friends down on the waterfront is to die. I found that out Tuesday night. I went to the wrestling matches and watched Gorgeous George throw some guy around like a poker chip in Tijuana. I was in the middle of the crowd on my way out of the place when this guy stepped up behind me and started talking.
You got company, Novak.
Huh?
I said you got company. On both sides.
Did your friend get his face at a fire sale, too?
Can't all be pretty. Keep walking, Novak.
Is the gun in my back supposed to help?
That's up to you. Straight ahead and out the side door.
You got the right growl, but the wrong guy, mister.
You keep working your mouth, but nothing comes out. All right, this way.
What are your plans? Shall we take the kids?
The car, right down here.
Now look, big shot. In a drugstore, I get all the mystery I want for 2 bits.
You want things explained?
Yeah, besides Shovelhead here, I don't understand a thing.
We just want Joe Denine.
I never heard of him either.
We just want Joe Denine.
All right, you can have him. You're welcome. See his wife. See anybody you like. I don't even know the guy.
You're full of talk. As soon as you want to make it the right kind, you can go home. Here we are, end of the back seat. You drive, Eddie.
You boys run on. I'll grab a cab.
Get in! You're not going to pick a boat. That's it. Just be a good mouse.
You got a lot of time to waste it this way, mister.
You're too gabby, Novak.
And you're too tough, Junior.
And this noise is beginning to give me a headache.
Oh!
Let's go, Eddie. Novak's going to sulk a while.
He could have taken 3 bases on that wallet. I spread out on the back seat like a bowl of cake batter and tried to think of a guy named Joe Denine. There was nobody on my list for that name. But the way these 2 dunces acted, he was supposed to be a blood relative. I could hear him talking dimly, and I tried to follow the conversation, but it was like trying to put a smoke ring in your pocket. I don't know how long the tour lasted. It must have been about 30 or 40 minutes when the car pulled up and the big gun up started to yank me.
Wake up! Wake up, sweet boy! Come on, it's time for your 10 o'clock feeding.
Yeah, wait till I borrow some legs, huh?
Come on, you never looked better. All right, down the dock here.
Are we playing a new game or hunting a guy named Denine?
That's right.
Good, now I know the rules.
Well, is that your boat, Novak?
It's got my name on it.
Is that your boat, Novak?
Well, what's it look like, the Normandy? Of course it's my boat. Who threw the blood all over it? One of your friends?
Maybe Denine.
Now, look, you better back up and start a recap. I never heard of Denine, and from the size of his friends, I'm just about as happy.
You mean he didn't rent a boat off you?
If he used that boat, he stole it, mister. I closed up tonight at 7.
You make it sound good.
It is good. I've been off the waterfront 4 hours. In the meantime, somebody takes my boat and gets a chuck full of holes and sends you around a week. Who is Denine?
A friend.
I don't blame either of you for hanging on to one.
We were supposed to meet him at your landing at 10. He was going to rent one of your boats, and we were going to meet him at 10.
There's the boat. You want to pay the damages?
We came early and found the boat piled up, blood all over, and no Denine. You got any ideas?
Maybe he cut himself shaving. Drag the bay, mister. I don't know your guy, but somebody did. They met him out there in the bay and cut him down.
You sound happy.
Now, look, I don't care one way or another, except he used my boat. If he wanted to die, he should have hired a Davenport. That's all I know. I never heard of Joe Denine.
Yeah.
You and your friend here better go sap somebody else.
Sure, Novak. We'll look around, but hang on to your cards because you still got a hand in this game.
Thanks, Mother. I'll remember that.
Watch out, Eddie! Watch out! Oh! You all right, Eddie? Nice curve, Novak.
You're wrong, mister. My friends ride the cable car.
You made a bum pitch, Novak. Can I trust?
All right, let go. You can't afford a fight now.
I want you for Eddie, Novak.
Sorry, fellow. The water's going to be cold.
Hey, what's the trouble? Trouble going on?
No. Whatever gave you that idea?
I'm a night watchman over here. That fellow lying on the dock there dead?
Well, if he's not, he's going to catch cold.
What about the other fellow? Maybe he can't swim.
What do you care? He doesn't.
Oh. They come here looking for something?
Yeah.
Guess they didn't find it, huh?
Somebody's satisfied. They were trying to find the guy that came out of that boat down there.
Oh, you mean the funny-looking guy?
Huh?
A guy got out of that boat a few hours ago, all banged up. I think he was in a fight.
Yeah?
Sure, somebody shot him. I think he was in a fight.
Where'd he go?
Down the dock toward the street. He asked about a fellow and went down the dock.
Oh.
He asked about a fellow named Novak. Do you know him?
Yeah, but I'll do my best to forget. It wasn't going to be easy to forget. I knew there was a guy wandering around San Francisco waiting to jog my memory. And before long, somebody was going to find out those two dead guys weren't doing light housekeeping down on the dock. Once homicides smell that red meat, they turn Inspector Hellman loose. That's like pouring a bottle of cyanide in a wedding cake. Oh, he's a smart cop with a heart the size of a full-grown pea. I got off the dock in a hurry and I went home. When I left, the watchman was still standing there waiting to check in the next murder and smiling like a vulture with the first option on a massacre. Well, I had to get home and look sweet in case Hellman showed up. When I opened the door to my place, Hellman was on the couch with a pencil in one hand and a movie magazine in the other.
Hello, Novak. You busy?
No, I'll just stand here and watch you. A little more of that pencil and movie magazine routine and you'll break out in a cold sweat.
Where have you been?
Staying out of other people's apartments.
I got an answer for that.
You haven't got an answer for anything, Hellman. You can't fill in the return address envelope. What's on your mind?
Can I make a call?
No, not to play cat and mouse. If you want to know about that bloodbath down on the dock, say so.
Yeah?
They're close strangers. I never saw either of them before.
You're getting loose around the mouth, Novak.
Huh?
That's right. If some of your playmates stub their toes, it's news to me. You better tell me, though. It'll save time.
Well, what's the use? If a fact walked up and sat in your lap, you'd lose it.
Eat yourself. Have a drink?
Yeah, I will. Where's the bottle opener?
Huh?
The bottle opener. You got teeth for it. I need a bottle opener, Helen.
I don't know. Try the kitchen.
All right.
Try the light.
Well.
About this guy on the floor, Novak. Don't tell him to move because I don't think he can.
When I looked down at the guy on the floor, I felt like a burlap sack from the neck down. He was a big guy lying on his back, and you got the idea he took it hard. He didn't like the way the vote came in, because he wasn't relaxed the way most people are when they're on the prowl for a harp. He was about as rigid as a coil of wet line on a steamer deck. His face was pockmarked and the color of an old piece of abalone. Hellman was standing over him, and the shadow cut across the lower part of his face. It almost blocked out the gun, a big .38 lying about 4 feet away. The rest of the kitchen was a mess. It was torn up worse than a Japanese lantern in a high wind. Hellman was leaning against the cabinet and smiling like the banker in a crooked blackjack game.
Does he belong to you, Novak?
No, he's not pretty enough. Roll him over. We'll find out who he is.
I've already been through his stuff.
Wipe your hands. The green still shows.
His name is Joe Denine.
You sure were popular, Joe.
Why?
The scavenger hunt. Every gonop in town's been looking for him.
I figured you for the prize.
Two of them picked me up and lugged me down to the waterfront.
Yeah?
I told you about them. They ran into bad weather.
Why'd they take you?
Because I look like a bird dog, maybe. I don't know why, Elman. They just took me. In the meantime, Sunshine here took my boat out and got shot up.
And he came up here to borrow your adhesive tape.
That's all I know, Hellman. He must have figured me for a part.
I got the same trouble, Novak. That gun on the floor helps, too.
That gun's second lead at best. I never saw it before.
It's a murder gun. How'd it get here?
I don't know.
Maybe the skull we made left it. Come on, Novak. You're in the spot. You better start digging.
If I do any digging, the dirt's going to go in your face, Hellman.
You've got a nice face, too, Novak.
You better buy a big shield, Hellman. You've got a lot to hide behind.
Stop beefing. You're the host. What about the safety deposit box?
You're ahead of me on that one. You ought to have your picture taken.
He was talking about a safety deposit box when I got here.
It was alive when you got here?
That's right. Show more joy. The neighbors heard the shooting and phoned in.
Well, who did it? What did he say?
He said, tough luck, copper. That's all he said. Something about a safety deposit box and tough luck, copper.
Oh, that's real fine. You let him die clammed up. You're smart, Hellman. You let him off with a third-rate tagline.
You're lucky, Novak. This way it's going to take me 12 hours to wrap you up. I'm going to run that gun through and check a couple of things, and I'll be on your tail.
I want to see you follow something up, Hellman. With that big nose of yours, you couldn't find a moose in the bathtub.
Look, Novak, you're a small-time waterfront punk. You've been lucky so far, but you're still a punk. I don't like you, and I'm going to hang you by your heels. I'm going to get you. If it's the last thing I ever do, I'm going to get you.
Hellman, if I thought you were on the level about that, I'd give myself up. When Hellman left, things were about as dim as a glowworm at high noon. All the leads were tucked away in the morgue. Those two stiffs on the dock checked out with nothing but a grunt, and the guy up in my place left a .38 and some mild regrets. I had the funny feeling there was a lead up there in that apartment, but I couldn't get a hold of it.
something waiting to be understood, the way a thing gets balanced on the edge of your brain, half in, half out, like the melody but not the words of an old song. Well, I didn't know where to turn. I was hunting for the shoreline on a dark night. So I looked up the only honest guy I know, an ex-doctor and a boozer by the name of Jocko Madigan. Well, he's all right, but he's got the idea that all liquid that isn't 100 proof lacks character. I finally found him in a little bar down near Union Square. He was talking to a blonde girl and a sailor when I walked in.
Ah, Patsy. You find me in the late October of my life, trying to recapture a few April moments.
Yeah, Jocko, I gotta talk to you.
That's what I like about good whiskey. It makes you too sentimental to be mad at yourself for growing old.
Now, look, I'm in a jam. Lay off that stuff long enough to listen.
Patsy, you underrate the grape. It's a terrible mistake. It's thrown off the whole perspective of history.
All right, Jocko.
Like that story about young Washington and the cherry tree. They blame him for that. But actually, it was his first hint of future greatness.
Yeah, yeah.
They talk about vandalism, whereas the truth of the matter is he was just preparing a few Manhattans for the family. The whole perspective of history has been altered, Patsy.
Oh, stop it, will you? I'm in trouble. Will you help me out?
Yes, if you'll allow me to get a word in edgewise. What kind of trouble?
There's a dead guy up in my place.
Oh, I don't know why you're in trouble. Think of his bleak outlook on things.
Hellman's nosing around and he thinks I did it.
Did you?
No, he got shot in relays, but he picked my place to quit. And there are two other dead guys down on the dock.
What were their practices?
They strong-armed me about 10 o'clock and took me down to the waterfront. We were supposed to find a guy named Joe Denine, but they looked too ripe to somebody.
How about Denine?
He's that guy up at my place. When Hellman got there, he was muttering about a safety deposit box and staring at a big 38. Oh, come on. You got to help me, Jocko.
Yes, where would you like me to spread the ashes?
I want you to get out and find out everything you can about Joe Denine, will you?
He's your house guest. Why don't you go?
Hit the Chronicle and the Examiner morgues and try to find out if he has a safety deposit box in any of the banks, huh?
Where are you going? Before prison, I mean.
I'm going down and lie in Hellman's shadow until something turns up. I need every minute, Jocko, so hurry.
Well, I'll need a quick one for the road first.
You'll get going right now, Jocko.
Patsy, you have a defiant attitude for a man on the doorstep to the next world. Try to be sweeter until you discover your normal disposition will do. You can start by paying my bar bill.
All right. Will you hurry? How much do you owe?
About $11.
What have you been doing all night? Are you crazy?
I may owe $11, Patsy, but so far I've had a better night than you have. Good night, lover.
I had to get started on some answers because once Hellman checked on those two guys at the dock, he'd go to work on me. He'd keep hacking away and finally cut me down like a piece of flint in a cigarette lighter. Well, after I left Jocko, I started down to headquarters. It was a little after midnight and the streets were wet and silent. Except that now and then you could hear a woman's laughter coming out of the dark as you passed along. That's the only sound the night keeps whole. Well, I was cutting down Leavenworth Street when it came to me. I knew what my lead was up in that apartment. It didn't hit me suddenly. It kept shoving in like a piece of old seaweed on the water, moving in and out and finally brushing up against you. If that guy was alive when Hellman got there, that meant that maybe he could have phoned somebody. And if he did, then they'd have a record of it down at the desk. Well, I got back to my place and asked the operator. Well, it feels good when you got the right sweepstakes ticket. She said a call had been put in from my place at 10:15 to the Ambrose Hotel, room 204. Well, at last, things were beginning to make sense. They must have made sense for about 5 seconds because Hellman called. The girl handed me the phone and he started in.
I got news for you, Novak. We checked the prints on that murder gun. They don't add.
Take your troubles to the chaplain, Hellman. I got my quota.
Yeah. You got fancy friends, too, Novak. The prints belong to Jake Fidello.
Yeah? How do you spell that?
F-I-D... You're killed, aren't you, Novak?
So Jake Fidello, I'm nothing. Who is he?
Cheap punk like you, Novak. He's working on a 20-year stretch in Alcatraz.
Huh?
Yeah, Alcatraz. So there's no tie between the murder gun and the murder.
Maybe Fidello bought himself a 2-day furlough.
We already checked. The guard saw him in his cell at 11 o'clock tonight reading a book.
Guards pay the rent too, Hellman. My boat was out in that bay tonight and it came back full of bullets and blood. Now you're trying to tell me there's no connection. You better find out if a guy can skip Alcatraz for a few hours.
I'll wait, Novak. Maybe you can tell me how it's done before long.
Well, nothing matched now. It was like the chorus girl's legs in a cheap nightclub. If Jake Fidello was smart enough to beat Alcatraz for a couple of hours, then he wasn't dumb enough to leave that murder gun behind. And what was the connection between Denine and Jake Fidello? And who lived at the Ambrose Hotel? Well, I went up there to find out. It was a small place up near the top of Telegraph Hill, and when I rode by, I could see Alcatraz sitting out in the bay, a lonely island full of birthdays. The Ambrose turned out to be a high-toned little joint, the sort of place where the welcome mats printed in Old English. I went up to 204. The card in the door said Frederica Sims. I knocked, and when the door opened, it was like shaking hands with a flamethrower. She was a tall number, and she screamed Final Edition all over. She stood in the doorway for a minute and swayed in a nice, contented way, like a snake on the right diet. And when she said hello, you wanted to hand her your arm and say, twist.
Good evening.
Yeah. My name's Novak.
I'll remember. Won't you come in?
It'll save an argument.
Good. I hope you don't mind crowds, Mr. Novak.
She means me, Mr. Novak. I'm Mike Trevor.
And I'm Freddie Sims.
Well, that brings us up to date.
A drink would do so much more. You need a drink, Mr. Novak. You look a little dusty.
Don't mind her, Novak. She addresses all people as peasants.
All right, now suppose you two landowners tell me who killed Joe Denine.
You know, Mike, I don't think he wants the drink.
We'll all celebrate when you get around to Denine.
I don't think we know a man by the name of Denine, particularly if he's dead.
Yes, I'm sure we wouldn't like him.
Come on, let's drop the smart talk. Come on back in the saloon. A guy by the name of Joe Denine died all over my kitchen tonight.
Don't get tough, Novak. If you miss your dinner, all right, but don't come up here screaming about your dead friend.
Now, look, I'm about 10 feet behind a phone call. Denine put in a call for this number just before he died.
Then it was whimsy, Novak, or anything else you'd like to call it. We don't know the man. You can mull it over on your way downstairs.
Yeah, and you can use the time to think over that safety deposit box.
What safety deposit
box? Oh, you're jumping your cue, lady. Make it more casual, huh?
Do you know what you're talking about, Novak?
You think so.
I'll tell you what I'll do, Novak. I'll buy that key from you.
You got a deal, unless you want to pay it off with money.
You mean Joe Denine?
That's right. I'm running front on a murder rap. You want that key. If you want it bad enough, come on down to headquarters and we'll make a trade.
No, thanks, Novak. You didn't look bright, but I thought you might be hiding your brain somewhere. This way you lose money.
You lose even more, Trevor. I was going to ease you into that murder rap, but the offer's out. You'll have to struggle in and you'll be too tired to get out.
Can I loan either of you boys a pickaxe?
No, thanks. Well, I'm going to run along. Can I drop you anyplace, Novak?
I'll stay.
You know, I didn't think I could drop you anyplace. Novak, you ought to sell that gleam in your eye. Some airport could use it. Good night, Freddy. Be careful.
Good night, Mike. I can take care of myself.
Yes, if you try. That's all I was worried about.
Your friend reads the wrong books.
I'll bet you never wasted your time that way. Why don't you sit down on the couch here and have a drink, Patsy? Now that the argument's over.
Is it?
Well, at least we need a drink.
Yeah, sure. That'll make the talk some easy. About that key.
Do you think I want the key?
Like nothing else in the world.
No, that's a little rash, Patsy. But I do want it. I want it very badly.
Those are famous last words, lady. You heard the round with Mike. The prices haven't changed.
Mm-hmm. That's too expensive, darling. Here's your drink. What are you looking at, Patsy?
You? The way you slide around on that couch?
Yes.
Yeah. You belong in the Everglades.
If I were there, Patsy, I think you're the kind of a guy who'd be right around the next bend.
You sound pretty sure. That's a good way to lose your shirt.
I am sure, Patsy. I know that about us. We belong in the swamp.
Yeah.
We belong together. Because we're the same kind. We're neither good nor bad. We just are. And that has to do.
You make it sound corny, baby.
Try to hide, darling, but I can see you peeking through your fingers. I can see you awfully good from here, Patsy.
Watch out. You're backing into a corner, Angel.
But I've got you with me.
Make some more noise, huh? I like it.
It's true. I've got you with me, haven't I, Patsy?
I can still struggle.
And I'll bet you don't struggle good. I'll bet you don't struggle good at all, Patsy.
I still got that key, baby.
Yes, you see.
It stays at my place.
I could eat you, Patsy. You're wonderful.
Yeah.
You never inhale me my drink. You stood at the end of the table.
Sure.
That's it, darling.
It doesn't pay much to fall in love.
I spent enough time on her rug to work my way into the design. And when I finally came to, it was morning. There was nobody around the place, so I started for home. On the way, I tried to fill in the blind spots, but it was like trying to match pearls in the dark. Somebody had killed Denine for the key to that safety deposit box, but where was the key? If the girl or Mike Trevor did it, then why were they still on the trail? Well, when I got to my apartment, the place was torn apart. Looked something like a mop closet after a New Year's Eve party. Jocko was sitting in the middle of the room listening to the water fizz.
Good morning. Where'd you get the bump on the head?
Romance. What'd you find out, Jocko?
Denine had lots of friends and enemies.
Yeah, one of them's Jake Fidello.
He's number one on the list. Denine had a brawl with Fidello 2 years ago. Jake promised to square the beef.
He's in a bad spot for it now.
Maybe. Denine has no safety deposit box.
Oh, that was my out.
Perhaps you can take up folk dancing in prison. I'll send you diagrams of new steps from time to time. Fidello has a safety deposit box, though.
Yeah?
Yeah, he's got a lot of money floating around somewhere.
Well, well.
And a lot of women doing the same thing.
We're getting a better shuffle now. Is the girl's name Freddie Sims?
That's right. Fidello loves her like the last 15 minutes of life. That's why he won't like it.
Get to the point, huh?
She's supposed to be waiting for him, but she's got married in Mexico to a guy named Mike Trevor, Fidello's best friend. Does it make sense?
No, it doesn't. Suppose Jake's found out about his sweetheart and best friend. Why would he kill Denine?
I don't know, except you'll find out, Patsy, that sometimes the difference between your best friend and your worst enemy is only a matter of opportunity.
Yeah, Novak talking.
How's the dent in your forehead?
Oh, you get around, Hellman.
Yeah, we picked her up at your apartment.
Did she tell you about that key?
A little. She made a confession, too.
She's generous.
Not to Mike Trevor. She pinned the whole thing on him and signed a statement. We're going out to pick him up now. I'll see you in 10 minutes.
Why?
In case he wants to shoot somebody, I'm offering you.
Things were moving fast now. I sent Jocko down to start repair work on the boat, and Hellman picked me up 5 minutes later. We drove out Geary and turned on Van S. Oh, Hellman was real subtle. He stopped right in front of the rooming house where Mike Trevor was living. The girl had mapped it out for him. Trevor was in a first-floor room. It was a quiet neighborhood. But as we opened the front door and started in, I got the idea it was going to be a tough place to get any sleep for the next few minutes.
Down on the right side here. Stay ahead of me, Novak.
You're one copper who will die in bed, Hellman.
Down the hall and be quiet. Yeah, this is it.
On this lap, you go first.
Stand back while I throw it open.
That empty, Hellman.
Girl said he was here. What's that?
Your boy's up at the top of the stairs.
You see him?
Well, he's not wearing neon pants. Go up and get him.
Come on down, Trevor. Your girl talks. Come on down and sign a confession.
I've got a better idea, copper. You come up and hand me the pen.
All right, Novak.
Move over, Hellman. He's going to argue.
He's heading for the roof. Let's go.
Hold it, Hellman. If that door up there is locked, we'll run right through the barrel.
You get one more chance, Trevor. Come on down.
That roof door is locked.
All right, copper. I'm coming down. Make a hole.
Now you got your hole, Trevor.
Yeah.
No, Vic. You better get to that safety deposit box. Get there in a hurry. Before the girl.
Well, the city owns a metal, Hellman. Let's get to that safety deposit box.
Let her have the key. What do you care, Novak? She's Fidello's girl.
No, no. There's a queer twist here somewhere. How do you know what's in that box?
So, Fidello's in love with a girl. He's grateful. What do you care?
That's what makes it good. That's the way it is with love and gratitude. The love goes on, Hellman, but the gratitude changes. Well, the way things stood, there was only one place that key could be. I got to a phone and called Jocko. I told him to check out on the boat for a key somewhere on the floorboards. Jocko seemed happy when he said that some girl had come by 15 minutes ago and nosed around the boat for a while. But Hellman and I rushed down to the bank. When we got downstairs, Freddie was just starting into the vault.
Hello, Patsy.
You look rested.
You're on your way to that deposit box. You better think it over.
Can he stop me, Copper?
No, but we can hold the dough until we check with Fidello.
Go ahead.
I don't think he's going to like it.
Oh, we'll have to see. I'll be back in a moment.
Let's go, Novak. We can hold the dough upstairs.
No, let's hang around. I just want to see 18 karat greed when she opens that box. There's the gratitude helmet.
Well, Captain, I got the key, huh?
Well, you got everything, Eva.
How about Mike? What happened to him?
He beat you over the line by 20 minutes.
Okay. That's enough. I'd let me know.
I'll try again. Because you don't rate him nicely. You're not worth anything Fidello ever had.
It's a lot of argument. I couldn't finish him.
I was wrong about one thing, Eva. When I said Fidello wouldn't like this. I think you will.
Yeah.
Fidello was a thorough guy. The way he told out, but the right inning. Fidello found out about the girl and Mike Trevor, so he pulled a switch. He hired his enemy, Joe Denine, to do the job. Denine planted the bomb in the safety deposit box, and just to prove it was a square pitch, Fidello gave Denine was supposed to kill the girl and leave the key for Mike to blow his head off. And just to make it clean, Fidello got in touch and told him to look up Denine if anything happened to the girl. That way, he figured to knock out all three of them. But Mike jumped the gun. He started tailing Denine and shot him up out on the bay. He followed him to my place and killed him with the gun Denine was carrying. Denine came across, but he called the girl and told her there was a lot of money in that safety deposit box.
Exactly, baby.
But he said the girl finally double-crossed Mike Trevor and turned him in. Trevor killed those two guys on the pier, and he lost Denine in the fog. And when he drove up, a couple of dumpers along got scared. The question, what could that girl have said to Jocko to make him let her walk in and breeze out with that key? I mentioned that to Jocko, but he just smiled.
It brought you Pat Novak for Hire, starring Jack Webb. Pat Novak is directed and produced by William D. Rousseau. Jocko Madigan is played by Tudor Owen. Inspector Hellman is played by Raymond Burr.
Music was composed and
in our cast were Vaughn Fahey, Paul Avery, Harley Bear, and Herb Ellis. This program is being released to our worldwide facilities of the Armed Forces Radio Service. This is George Fenneman inviting you to be with us again next week. And over most of these same ABC stations, we'll bring you Pat Novak for Hire. This program came to you from Hollywood. This is ABC, the American Broadcasting Company.
To hear is true. Only the names have been changed to protect the innocent.
Fatima Cigarettes, best of all long cigarettes, brings you Dragnet.
You're a detective sergeant. You're assigned a homicide detail. A socially prominent citizen is plotting to kill his wife. He tells you his plans for the murder. He hires you to do the killing. Your job, stop him.
When you compare Fatima with other long cigarettes, the difference is quality.
Yes, in Fatima, the difference is quality. If you want a long cigarette, smoke the best of all long cigarettes. smoke extra mild Fatima. Fatima is the quality, king-size cigarette because it contains the finest Turkish and domestic tobaccos, superbly blended. And Fatima is extra mild, with a much different, much better flavor and aroma than any other long cigarette. Because of its quality, its extra mildness, its better flavor and aroma, Fatima has more than doubled its smokers coast to coast. So enjoy extra mild Fatima yourself.
You'll find king-size Fatima different from other long cigarettes. They cost the same, but in Fatima, the difference is quality.
Smoke Fatima, the quality king-size cigarette. Best of all, long cigarettes.
Dragnet, the documented drama of an actual crime. For the next 30 minutes, in cooperation with the Los Angeles Police Department, you will travel step by step on the side of the law through an actual case from official police files. From beginning to end, from crime to punishment, Dragnet is the story of your police force in action.
It was Monday, February 17th. It was raining in Los Angeles. We were working a day watch out of homicide detail. My partner's Ben Romero. The boss is Thad Brown, chief of detectives. My name's Friday. It was 4:18 p.m. when we got to room 26, chief of detective's office.
Come on in, man. Have a seat. Did you close the door, Friday?
Yeah, sure.
Captain Steed, Sergeant Romero, Sergeant Friday. I'd like to have you meet Special Agent Ray Kimball, Public Utilities Commissioner.
Hi, Mr. Kimball.
And his friend, Mr. Trudeau.
How do you
Mr. Trudeau.
How
are you, sir?
Gentlemen, Mr. Kimball and Mr. Trudeau here have some important information to give us. Mr. Trudeau, would you like to repeat for these officers what you told us a few moments ago?
Yes, sir. Well, a friend of mine wants me to kill his wife for him. I'm convinced he means to go through with the thing.
Naturally, it goes without saying that Kimball here will back up the veracity of the story.
Well, Mr. Trudeau, who is your friend? How long have you known him?
His name's Charles Stone. Guess maybe you heard of him. Owns a string of warehouses around town. I used to work for him.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
Well, the other day he called me and asked me if I was working. I told him no. Then he asked me to meet him in front of the public library. And that was last Saturday afternoon.
But did you meet him?
Yes, I did. And he took me to a bar in the neighborhood, started telling me all about his troubles at home.
Mm-hmm.
He said his wife was stepping out on him, running around with other men. Well, we had quite a few drinks, and I guess I thought that's what accounted for it.
What's that, Mr. Trudeau?
Well, he leaned toward me and he said, "Here's the dope. The wife and I haven't been getting along well at all for about a year. She's stepping out with some other guy on me, and to make a long story short, well, that's when he told me.
I see.
He said, I want to lose her. What do you say? Well, I told him I didn't quite get the drift of the thing, and then he said, I want my wife killed. I'll pay you $1,000 for the job.
Mr. Trudeau, have you any idea why he contacted you on this thing?
Well, I don't know, other than the fact that I hadn't been able to work for some time. He knew I needed the money pretty badly. As soon as I was sure he wasn't kidding about the murder, I told Mr. Kimball here, he's an old friend of mine.
Yeah.
He said the only thing to do was to take it to the police.
Did this Mr. Stone make this proposition to you more than once?
Yes, he did. Kept reminding me how much I could use $1,000. Well, all I could say was that I knew his wife too well. I couldn't do it.
And what did Stone say to that, sir?
Said I had cold feet. Told me I was just like another man he'd lined up to kill his wife. Told me if I didn't want the job, he'd get someone else to do it.
Do you think he might go for a substitute, Mr. Trudeau, one of our men?
Well, I don't know, Chief. Only one thing I'm sure of.
Yes, sir.
He wants his wife dead.
4:42 p.m. The meeting in the chief of detectives' office went on. A man by the name of Charles Stone wanted his wife murdered. He'd offered $1,000 for her death. He'd approached two men to do the job. Both had refused. From the information we'd received, we knew he wouldn't stop there. There are a lot of people who'd kill for $1,000. It was only a matter of time till he found one. The plan was formulated and Ben and I were assigned to the case. 5 p.m. Together with Captain Steed and Mr. Trudeau, we left Thad Brown's office and went down the hall to homicide.
In your last meeting with Stone, Mr. Trudeau, you refused outright to have anything to do with this plan to have his wife murdered. Is that right?
That's right.
Did you leave any opening at all?
Well, just to get away from the guy, I told him if I heard of anybody that'd do the job, I'd let him know.
You think that maybe he'd listen to you if you went back and suggested somebody?
I don't know. He'd listen to me, but he's no dummy. You got to understand that. He's going to be careful.
Mm-hmm. Well, which one of you is going to play the killer?
I'd like to try it, Skipper.
Who's going to fit the part best? Trudy here just told you that Charles Stone's no pushover.
I don't know, Captain. This officer here...
Me?
Yeah, no offense, but I'd sure peg you for a cop.
You would? Why's that?
Well, I don't know. You just look like one, I guess.
Well, Joe is a little closer to average height, weight.
Yeah, that's what I mean, Captain. He doesn't look like a cop.
All right. Now, Mr. Trudeau, you're willing to go along with us on this thing?
Certainly, Captain. Anything I can do. You just tell me what you want.
Well, just as soon as possible, we'd like to have you contact Mr. Stone. You'll know how to approach him so as not to make him suspicious.
Yes, I think I can do that.
Joe, how do you want to go about this?
Well, I better use some kind of an alias. Let's see, Matson. Joe Matson.
Mm-hmm. How about Kelly? Just plain Kelly.
That's fine with me.
Good. Now, how about your background? Better get that straight with Mr. Trudeau here.
Well, suppose I tell him I'm from Phoenix, huh? Mm-hmm. I know that town pretty well. He might ask me some questions about it.
Okay. Now, how'd you happen to know Trudeau, the Army?
Did you ever serve in the Army, Mr. Trudeau?
Yes, sir. 42 to 45, CBI theater.
All right. Well, we served together in the Army, huh? Let's make it in China. Mm-hmm. Quartermaster Corps, all right?
Mm-hmm. All right. And now, Mr. Trudeau, this is all you'll have to do. Set up a meeting with Stone as soon as possible. Introduce Friday as the man who's willing to do the job for him, an old Army friend. Then step out of the picture as quickly as you can.
All right, Captain. I understand.
It goes without saying, we certainly appreciate your cooperation.
And not at all, sir. Only glad I'm in a position to help out.
You'll probably save that woman's life.
I wish I could be sure.
How do you mean, Trudeau?
The last time I saw Charlie Stone was 3 days ago.
Maybe he's hired somebody else.
p.m. Captain Steed ordered two teams of men from homicide to watch Charles Stone's wife, Mildred, until further notice. For her own protection, she'd be kept under 24-hour surveillance without her knowledge. We checked the Eye Bureau to see what we could find on Charles Stone. He owned a gun, a .32 Smith & Wesson revolver. That's all we found. He had no criminal record. We knew of him only as a social figure from a prominent family, and supposedly he was happily married. He owned and operated a chain of 6 warehouses throughout Los Angeles. His business reputation was good. Captain Steed ordered that Charles Stone also be placed under 24-hour surveillance immediately. He would be kept under watch without his knowledge. Ben Romero and Gil Encinas were one of the teams assigned to tail him. The next morning, I checked in for work at the usual time. At 10:15 a.m., I left Captain Steed's office and went into the squad room. Homicide, Friday.
This is Mr. Trudeau, Sergeant. I saw Charlie Stone a few minutes ago.
Yes, sir. How'd it go?
We talked about 20 minutes. I told him you might be willing to do the job.
What'd he say?
He wants to meet you.
Before he hung up, Trudeau told me that Charles Stone would meet us that night in Section B in the grandstands at the midget auto races out near Santa Monica. I informed Captain Steed of the development, and then I left the office, went home, put away my gun and all my identification, changed into some old clothes. I boarded a bus and rode back downtown to the Skid Row area where I rented a single room in a cheap hotel. I signed the register J. Kelly, Phoenix, Arizona. 5:30 p.m., I went to Coken's Cafe on the corner of South Main and Sotelo Streets. Captain Steed was waiting for me in one of the rear booths.
Hi.
Hi.
You look like you're all set.
How's the outfit strike you, okay?
You're fine. That old leather jacket's a good touch. Oh, I better let your beard grow a little.
All right. I rented a room in one of the hotels down here. I could use a little expense money.
Glad you said a little. All right, I'll fix it up for you.
Here's the phone number of the hotel in case you want to contact me.
Good.
There's one thing that's got me a little worried, Skipper.
Yeah?
The legal angle. You know, you can get pretty close to entrapment in cases like this.
Nothing to worry about. You just play it straight down the line.
Yeah?
The idea for the crime has to originate in the mind of the criminal. It's got to be all his idea. Mm-hmm. You just go along with him.
Okay.
Be sure and keep us posted.
Yes, I will.
Murder of his wife means a lot to Stone. He wouldn't want anybody getting his way.
Yeah.
Be careful.
That night, I had dinner with Trudeau at a cafeteria on South Grand. And then we caught a bus and rode out to the stadium where they held the midget auto races. We found the seats where Charles Stone was to meet us, numbers 4 and 5, row 27, section B, main grandstand. The auto races started. At 10 minutes past 8 p.m., Charles Stone arrived. He looked like an average prosperous businessman, well-dressed, medium build, dark hair that showed a few streaks of gray. Trudeau introduced us, and then he left.
Where are you from, Kelly?
Phoenix.
Like midget auto races?
A
That's not why I came out here. Trudeau said something about a job.
Sure. Guess he told you what it's about.
Yeah?
You ever handle anything like this before?
I'd be a sucker to answer that one, wouldn't I?
I just want to know if you could handle it.
Trudeau told me about it. I wouldn't be here if I couldn't handle it.
Delicate job. Gotta be sure it's done right.
What are you looking for? References?
Gotta be careful, that's all.
Well, what about me? I don't know you from Adam. How do I know it won't be a double cross?
Don't worry about a double cross. Let's go below the grandstand. Get away from this crowd.
Fly with me. You haven't said anything about money yet.
Plenty of time to talk money.
I'd like to know.
How much you want?
Trudeau said 1,000.
Yeah.
When could you get it?
When would you want it?
Before. I'd be a dope to do the job without getting paid first.
I'd be just as stupid to give it to you first. Say, can I buy you a hot dog, cold drink?
Okay.
Miss?
Yeah?
One hot dog, couple of root beers?
One dog, two beers.
You like root beer?
Sure. How about settling on the dough, huh?
You do the job, you'll get paid. You can ask Trudeau if you like. He'll tell you I keep my word.
Well, it's got to go fast, that's all. I may have a job lined up in Phoenix. I got to get that dough and some new clothes. Got to put up some kind of a front. That's why I need the dough fast, no waiting.
You'll get your money. We can work out something.
Hot dog, 2 liters, 40. Mustard's on the counter.
There you are.
Mm-hmm.
Just move over there out of the way.
Okay. But you haven't told me yet.
What?
How do you want it done?
All depends.
I haven't got my gun. I'm on the lam. Have you got one?
No, I don't own one. Couldn't use a gun anyway. Too much noise.
Well, make up your mind.
We'll meet tomorrow night. We can talk about it then.
Look, mister, you expect me to sit on this thing for a week? I'm not making a career out of just this one job.
What are you worrying about? We'll set everything up tomorrow night.
All right, how about $10 on the cuff? I got 11 flat.
Well, that's fine. See if that'll do.
Now, how about that payoff, the 1,000? How do we set that up?
We can talk about that later.
Why can't we talk now? Look, Stone, I don't think I like your attitude. You haven't told me how you want the job done. You talk cute every time the payoff's mentioned.
Take it easy,
Take it easy, nothing. I'm taking the chances. How do I know I'm going to get paid?
How do I know you'll kill her?
Before I left Charles Stone, we set up a meeting for the following night at 8 o'clock. I caught a bus and went back to the hotel room. So far, I'd been unable to get any other corroborative evidence on Stone, evidence that could be presented in court. The next morning, I called the office and kept them posted on developments. I had my meals at a lunch counter next door to the hotel, and I stuck pretty close to my room. At 2:30 that afternoon, Ben called.
We tailed Stone to the midget auto races last night, Joe. Did any good?
Well, not bad. It's going a little slow, though.
We tailed him after he left you. He drove to a Beverly Hills address, apartment house.
I thought he lived in Glendale.
Does. The apartment he went to is registered to Jean Howard. Stayed till 4 this morning. Checked the Howard girl out. She's a secretary at one of Stone's warehouses.
Maybe that explains why Stone wants to get rid of his wife, huh?
Here's one more thing. We tailed him to a gun shop this morning. Bought a couple of things, and after he's gone, we checked with the store clerk. Told us Stone bought a box of shells, 32 caliber.
Same kind of gun he had registered in it, 32 S&W?
Yeah.
That's funny. Stone told me he doesn't own a gun.
Doesn't look too good in my book.
All right, now let's don't start worrying, huh?
Don't trust him a dime's worth, Joe, that's all.
All right. You want to check with me later on? I've got to keep this line open.
Yeah, all right. See you later.
Right. Yeah?
This is Stone.
Yeah?
Job's all set up, ready to go.
When?
Tomorrow night.
You are listening to Dragnet, the case history of a police investigation presented in the public interest by Fatima Cigarettes.
If you smoke a long cigarette, it will be in your interest to listen to a typical case history of a Fatima smoker.
It's the case of New York cover girl Rita Daigle. This is her actual signed statement.
I find Fatima different from other long cigarettes. They cost the same, but in Fatima, the difference is quality.
And they're extra mild.
You see, Fatima is the quality king-size cigarette because it contains the finest Turkish and domestic tobaccos, superbly blended.
And Fatima is extra mild, with a much different, much better flavor and aroma than any other long cigarette.
Because of its quality, its extra mildness, its better flavor and aroma, Fatima has more than doubled its smokers coast to coast.
So enjoy king-size Fatima yourself.
You will find king-size Fatima different from other long cigarettes.
They cost the same, but in Fatima, the difference is quality.
Yes, in Fatima, the difference is quality.
Ask your dealer for Fatima, the quality king-size cigarette. Best of all, long cigarettes. Start enjoying Fatima tomorrow.
Wednesday, February 19th, 8:55 p.m. Charles Stone picked me up in his car at the corner of Alameda and 6th Streets. He turned onto South Broadway and he headed down for the beach. He hunched over the wheel as he drove. I kept wondering how I was going to pin him down. We were less than 24 hours away from the scheduled murder of his wife, and I still didn't have a case against him that would stand up in court. If he failed to produce sufficient evidence tonight, Stone had a good chance of going free, whether he succeeded in having his wife killed or not. I also had no idea what plans the suspect had made before he hired me to do the killing. There was a definite possibility that he might have arranged for somebody else to commit the actual murder and then set up a double cross with me as the victim. We knew he had a .32 S&W revolver registered in his name, but he denied to me that he even owned a gun. 9:03 p.m., we pulled up in front of Stone's beach house.
Most of the other homes around here are vacant summer places. People don't start moving in till 1st of May.
But you said you're afraid of the neighbors seeing you here.
There's some living up the next block. Oh. Can't afford not to be careful. This one here. There's the front door key. See if you can work it.
I know how it works. You go ahead and open it.
All right.
Living room, huh?
Yeah, bedroom's over here through this door.
All right, what's the story? Where do I start?
My wife should be here about 6 o'clock tomorrow night. She'll be coming down alone to get the house ready for a weekend party.
When do you want me here?
About 4 in the afternoon. Here. Here's the key to the front door.
Better pick it up and hand it to me, huh?
Okay, here you go. First thing you do when you get here is pull out all the drawers in the bedroom bureau, scatter things around, make it look as much like a burglary as you can.
Yeah.
Same here in the living room. Desk drawer, table, cupboards. Turn them inside out, throw things around.
Leave my fingerprints all over everything?
I've taken care of that. Old pair of gloves of mine. You'll find them here in this drawer, remember that.
All right.
Let's see now, Oh, yeah, sash cord. I'm sure this ought to serve the purpose. Shouldn't have any trouble.
Yeah. Piece of rope's pretty new. It's a little slippery.
Won't be with the gloves on. She's not very strong. Shouldn't have any trouble. I'll leave the rope here in the closet.
You sure she's going to be alone?
Positive.
Where am I supposed to hide?
Let me show you. Here. Right by the front door. This closet.
Yeah.
When my wife comes in, closes the door, she'll probably go right to the bedroom and take off her coat. Follow her in, then do it fast while her back's turned. No screams. Neighbors might hear.
All right.
Want to clean and quiet, do it as quickly as you can. Now, when you're finished, here's what I want you to do with her.
What's that?
Take the body and bring it this way. Come here. Here, I want you to see.
All right.
The living room to these French doors. Open this one. You won't have any trouble. Take the body out here on the porch. Come with me now. I want you to get this clear in your mind.
Yeah, I think I got it.
Take her down to this end of the porch, right to the railing, leave her here. It's very important, you understand? All the way down to the end of the porch here.
I don't get it, but I guess it's all right.
All right, let's go back in.
Look, Stone, I may forget the layout of this house here. Could you draw a floor plan for me? I don't want to get mixed up here.
No, there's paper on the desk there. You can draw it yourself before you leave tonight.
What's the matter? Don't you trust me?
Can't afford to take any chances. Now, what was it? Yeah. After you're finished using the rope, I mean.
Yeah.
You'll find some rings on my wife's fingers. Take them all off. Big setting especially. There'll be a bracelet on her left wrist. Take that, too.
What'll I do with them?
Put them in this white vase in the mantle here. The rings and the bracelet. Don't miss any of the rings. They're expensive.
Well, how about me bringing them to you? I can pick up my dough at the same time.
No, put them in the vase. As soon as that's done, leave here and go back downtown. I'll pick you up where we met tonight, 6th and Alameda, 7:30 sharp. I'll have the money for you then.
Where are you going to be at 6 o'clock?
I have to cover myself. I'll stay on at the office. Special conference.
I don't know. I don't think I like this.
What do you mean you don't like it?
Suppose something should happen. I got no protection. I'd feel a lot better with a gun.
I told you, I don't have a gun to give you. Why would you need one anyway?
Just feel a lot better, that's all.
Buy one if you want. That's your problem. I'm paying you for the job.
I haven't seen your money.
I told you, when the job's done, you get your money then.
There's just one thing I want to make sure of. No mistakes here.
Don't worry, you get your pay. Ask Trudeau if you like. He'll tell you you can trust him. You can ask anybody.
How about your wife? Before I left Charles Stone, I got one more valuable piece of evidence out of him, a special phone number written in his handwriting on the back of one of his business cards. In case anything went wrong, I was to call him at this number. In his own handwriting, I also got a list of times that I was supposed to remember, when to come to the house, when to leave, when to meet him for the payoff. The next afternoon at 3:30, I left the hotel and drove my car out to Venice to Stone's beach house. Captain Steed and another officer from Homicide followed me out. We waited in the house together. Shortly before 6 p.m., Mrs. Mildred Stone arrived with Biff, Ben, and Gil and Cenas. She refused to believe the story of her husband's plot to have her murdered. Captain Steed laid out the evidence for her.
This key, Mrs. Stone, you recognize it?
Well, yes, it's the one for the front door. It must be Charles.
He gave it to this officer, Mrs. Stone, the man who was supposed to murder you.
No, I don't believe it.
Do you have any idea what's in that closet, ma'am, that one over there?
There's nothing in there. I cleaned it out the last time we were here. I cleaned out all the closets.
I'd like to show it to you, ma'am.
Piece of rope? I never saw that there before.
Mr. Stone gave it to me. It was supposed to be the murder weapon.
Just one more point, ma'am. Over here, please. Do you know what's in this drawer here?
It's empty. It has to be. We never keep anything in there. Only when we move down for the summer months.
Joe?
Right. Pair of your husband's old gloves. Is that right, ma'am?
Well, why would they be there? What for?
I was supposed to wear them while I was in the house so I wouldn't leave fingerprints.
Do you mind if I sit down?
Here you are.
I'm sorry, Mrs. Stone. We know it's a terrible shock for you. I think you realize we had to tell you.
It's all right. You've been very kind. You saved my life. I'm sorry now that happened. Would have been better if he'd succeeded. Much better.
Take it easy, Mrs. Stone.
The shame. Terrible, terrible shame. Is there anything I can do for him?
He wanted to have you murdered, ma'am.
I know that. He wanted me dead.
Yes, ma'am.
There's only one thing.
Yeah?
He's my husband, Sergeant. I love him.
p.m. I telephoned Charles Stone and told him the job was done. His wife was murdered. He said he'd meet me at 6th and Alameda Streets for the payoff as scheduled. I waited. He failed to show up. At 7:30 p.m., Stone was placed under arrest as he parked his car in front of their Venice beach house. A loaded .32 caliber revolver was found in his pocket. He was taken back to the city hall, the chief of detective's office. Ben and I waited outside the open door. We could hear Thad Brown start the interrogation inside.
Do you know what we have you down here for, Mr. Stone?
No, I haven't the faintest idea.
What would you say if I told you your wife had been murdered?
I think you're crazy.
What would you say if I told you that you're accused of her murder?
It's silly. It's ridiculous. I've been at work all day. I can prove it.
All right, Friday, come in.
Yes, sir.
You ever meet this man before?
I've seen him on Skid Row. I don't know him.
Do you recognize the man you hired to kill your wife?
I don't know the man. I didn't kill my wife. I don't understand all this.
The name's Kelly, Mr. Stone.
He's some fake officer. He's a Skid Row bum. I don't know him.
I don't think that's going to make it, Stone. Both you and your wife have been tailed constantly for the last couple of days. Photographs taken. Midget auto races. 6th and Alameda. Beverly Hills apartment.
Crazy. You don't know what you're talking about.
Mike, would you send the lady in, please?
Hello, Mildred, you don't believe all these things you're saying about me, do you?
Here are the rings, Charles. The bracelet, too. I didn't realize how much you wanted them.
Mellie, I didn't mean it. I don't know what I was thinking of.
There, Charles. There, it's all right now. You'll feel better in a few minutes.
Yes, ma'am. That's all, Friday.
Right.
What's it look like, Joe?
He's starting to talk.
It's got me. He tries to have her murdered. She goes to bat for him.
What's it prove?
She sure must love him. What do you think?
How about a cup of coffee? Huh?
The story you have just heard was true. Only the names were changed to protect the innocent.
On May 2nd, trial was held in Superior Court, Department 89, City and County of Los Angeles, State of California. In a moment, the results of that trial.
And now, here is our star, Jack Webb.
Thank you. To the working detective, the difference between guilt and innocence is proof. In the form of physical evidence, in the form of testimony gathered from reliable witnesses. In determining any suspect's guilt or innocence, the difference is actual proof. Now, when you compare Fatima with other long cigarettes, the difference is quality. And Fatima is extra mild. If you're a long cigarette smoker like I am, smoke Fatima. You'll find Fatima different from other long cigarettes. They cost the same, but in Fatima, the difference is quality. Start enjoying Fatima tomorrow.
Charles Farnsworth Stone was tried and convicted on soliciting the commission of a felony, 2 counts. He received the sentence as prescribed by law. You have just heard Dragnet, a series of authentic cases from official files. Technical advice comes from the Office of Chief of Police W.H. Parker, Los Angeles Police Department.
Fatima Cigarettes, the best of all long cigarettes, has brought you Dragnet from Los Angeles.
Hi, folks. This is Bob on the air for Chesterfield. Every Tuesday night, consult your local paper for Time and Station Hope.
And Bing, on the air for Chesterfield every Wednesday night, Crosby. I've called this little seminar to teach our new boy the ropes.
Say, Sag, I think it's only fair to warn you, with me selling Chesterfields this year, you'll have to limp along lively to keep up.
Oh, say, since when have you been any competition, lover boy? When we're in pitches together, who always gets the girl?
Which only backs up the old saying, everybody loves a fat man.
Seriously, friends, Skinflint and I, we do agree 100% on this. Chesterfields are milder.
And they leave no unpleasant aftertaste. So always buy our cigarette, Chesterfield.
The best cigarette for you to smoke.
Hear Hope and Crosby Tuesday, next We the People on NBC.
Pete Kelly. It's about the world he goes around in. It's about the big music and the big trouble in the big 20s. When they ask you, tell them this one's about the blues. Pete Kelly's blues.
Pete Kelly's Blues, starring Jack Webb, with story by Jim Moser, music by Dick Cathcart. Number 417 Cherry Street is a standard speakeasy. The help is paid in cash, the books are burnt at the end of the month. Every week we use 30 cases of booze and a pound of coffee.
After salaries, there's gas and lights and a payoff to the Prohibition boys. In Kansas City, the price is good. For $100, they steer in the drunks and make one raid a year. The place is run by George Lupo. He's a quiet little guy who wouldn't give you the sweat off an ice pitcher. The beer's green and the gin's as young as yesterday and the music's loud. I'm Pete Kelly. I play cornet. We start every night about 10 o'clock and we play till they sweep out the broken glass. Well, we don't draw any customers. We don't chase any away. The music is straight New Orleans. It started in the front parlors of Storyville and drifted up north. Some of it laid over in Chicago. That's where I got on. And wrote it out here with a piano player named Augie. Well, he's still with the band, but last night he was barely with it. We took a break about 11. Augie was late getting back. Might as well have stayed in there because he kept looking around the room, and the way the piano sounded, you'd think he had on a catcher's mitt.
That'll do it. Let's get off for a while, huh?
Sorry, Pete. Running a little behind tonight.
You haven't left the station. What's the matter, Augie?
I'm nervous. Take a look around. Near the door, back this way. Place full of cops.
Don't forget it. Have Jake open a couple of windows. Take a walk. Get yourself in shape, huh?
Not till I find out which way to fall. Boys are here for heavy duty. I learned that out in the kitchen.
Now, let's duck behind the stand. All right, what about it?
You know that's Courtney?
I drink his beer, that's all.
Well, somebody shot Courtney up tonight out near Highway 40.
Well, that's too bad. He'd have drawn a good crowd downtown. Who killed him?
I don't know, but whoever he is in for a big night. The police are trying for him. So is his partner.
Well, let him play. How does our place fit into it?
I couldn't guess, but we'll find out soon. See the big guy that just walked in the door?
Yeah, boss cop?
Almost. It's Eddie Newman. That's Courtney's partner.
Come on, we better get back in the stand.
Kelly.
Yeah?
My name's Newman. Come outside.
Well, we're due to play.
I'll hear you later. Come on. You hear about Dutch, Courtney? Pick him out of the mud tonight.
Means nothing to me.
Does to me. Dutch was a friend.
Well, if it'll help, cry.
I'm short on time, Kelly. Now, give me a rundown on Gus Trudeau.
There's nothing to say. He played for a while and he went to the boneyard.
You know him. You know his sister.
You'll have to ask Courtney about that. I haven't seen her since the old days.
You knew Gus well enough to figure he didn't like Dutch Courtney. He didn't like him 1 pound.
Well, you can't blame him. Dutch sidestepped and paid Trudeau's way to jail.
Bookkeeping. I don't know anything about it.
All right, look, Newman. You're on the wrong track. This is a job killing. Your boy got frisky and somebody sent down a Chicago gun. The price tag shows.
Sorry, Trudeau's my pick.
What'd he hit him with? A high-powered rifle? Gus Trudeau's away up in Leavenworth.
He used to be. Gus went over the wall this morning. When he shows up, I want him.
Well, why pick me?
I've asked around. He'll head for you. He's broke. He'll need train fare.
No, not if he killed Dutch Courtney. Somebody will give him a railroad. When they dragged the blues out of the back room and moved them up front, there were three of the best leading the parade. They were all blowing cornets. One was Buddy Bolden, one was King Oliver, and the other was Gus Trudeau. Oh, he was a lot of music, but not much man. He picked me up on a union date on the south side of Chicago and taught me how to play. He got into me for a Boston three-star cornet and gin for the rest of his life. When he got down to running errands for Dutch Courtney, I left for Kansas City. A couple of months later, Courtney needed a patsy, and Trudeau was it. He wound up with a 5-year stand at Leavenworth. But Gus never felt right unless he was in trouble. Only this time, he cut me in for a piece, too. Well, I picked up a drink at the bar and fought my way back to the stand.
Anything wrong?
No. Did you finish the set?
One more to go, Jasmine.
All right, let's do it.
What's wrong, Pete? A
friend of ours killed Dutch Courtney. Jasmine.
get off for a while.
Now, who did you say killed Dutch Courtney?
That's Trudeau.
What with? Brad? Trudeau's in jail.
No, not since this morning.
Which one of you is Kelly?
I am.
A friend of yours in town wants to see you right away.
But who is it?
He's waiting up at your room.
Did he give a name?
Just Gus.
An hour later, I was still looking for an out. It was a little after 2 a.m. Our base man, Red, loaned me his car keys, and I slipped out. I got on to 12th Street and picked up his Erskine coupe and headed up for my room. All the way out Grand Avenue, the streetlights were spending the rest of New Year's alone. Some guys with wide brooms were pushing at the confetti, and the fog was loafing down in Washington Square. When I got to my place, I parked the car in back and headed up the stairs. College kids down at the end of the hall had their door open. Their party sounded young. I was looking for Gus when I opened the door, but he had a substitute. I knew her way back at 18th and Halstead. She was pretty and the fastest freight in town. That must have been a long time ago, because somewhere along the line, she'd run into a batch of Wednesday weekends. She wasn't pretty anymore.
Hello, Pete.
Where's your brother?
I don't know where Gus is. That's why I'm here. I knew you'd be the first one he'd come to.
Yeah. Now, what about the break?
I was up to see him 2 weeks ago. He didn't say anything about it. Pete, we've got to help him.
I've been hearing that since I met him.
You're the only one who remembers, Pete. You're the only one who cares.
Yeah, well, a lot of people care now. Eddie Newman wants him. The cops are looking hard.
I've got to find him before they do. You've got to help Pete.
He was supposed to meet me. That's all I know. I'll wait for him.
He needs a hand, Pete. He's in deep.
Yeah, well, he's always in deep. Now, you do what you want, Madge. I ran front for Gus too long. I'm out of the habit now.
Please.
Gus wants cover. He can look for a police station.
Gus can get away. Some money and a car. That's all he needs.
Yeah, it's going to take more than that to get out. Every cop in town's working tonight.
Oh, give him a chance, Pete. Help him.
No, no, thanks.
Gus has been good to you, Pete. He taught you music. He's been nothing but good to you.
I'm paid up. I bought his gin for 5 years.
And do it for me. For what I used to be worth.
No, it's old. It was 80 years ago. I can't help this.
Do it for me. I haven't changed that much.
I have.
You're still the same.
You've been working at it.
You remember.
Yeah.
It's the same, Petey. It's just like the first time.
You never had a first time. How about a drink?
Will you help me, Pete? Find Gus. Get him out of town.
All right. $10. As far as I go. $10 and a quarter. Now I'm getting off.
Where are you going?
Back to work. Tell Gus to take care of himself.
Hold it right there, Pete.
You stay too long in Chicago, Madge.
I bought the gun in Kansas City. Don't go for the door.
You better give it to Gus. He may need it.
We're going to find him. You're going to help me.
All right. Come on. Give me the gun, Madge.
If I shoot, it'll hurt. Yeah.
Come on. Put it away, Madge.
Oh, stop it.
Who's she?
Well, Trade. Who are you?
Cage. I work downtown on homicide. Who you got on your floor?
Madge Trudeau.
Tell me about her.
I knew her in Chicago. After that, I heard she did favors for Dutch Courtney. After that, I don't know.
Is she tired? What's she doing here?
Looking for Gus Trudeau.
Where is Gus?
I don't know. I've been asked that twice tonight. This is the third time I don't know.
You probably will.
Why? Why do I have to get into this?
Because you're Gus Trudeau's friend.
Then let's get him another one. I'm tired of the job.
I don't blame you, fella. You'll come out of this with a lot of trouble. I'll make it simple. If Gus Trudeau shows and you turn him over to Newman, we'll send you up as an accessory to murder. Yeah. If he shows and you turn him over to us, Newman will probably kill you.
Oh, that's real good. In the meantime, what do you guys do for a living?
We're busy. We couldn't prove Newman killed you. It's after 2. Get back to that club.
We'll leave you here?
I got work to do.
Like what?
This woman. I'll see if I can get anything out of her.
Yeah, well, it's been done before, but I'll bet 10-1 in your case.
Go on back. I'll side you up here.
Good night, cop. Leave the rugs. I left Cage standing in the middle of the room looking down at Madge Trudeau. He didn't watch me leave, but I figured it wouldn't be too long before he turned that gleam back on me. Well, I went back to 417 and ran into our piano man, Augie, outside in the alley trying to steal some clean air.
Happy holidays, Petey. I've got.
I didn't see him.
Oh, forget him. I got it all figured out for the two of us, Petey. Today we'll spend our time dodging destiny. We'll hit for some small back room. I'll bring the bottle goods and we'll live on gin and sauerkraut and make the walls sit up and listen. One horn, one piano. The blues, Petey. We'll write them in the middle of next year.
All right, save it. Will you just set me straight?
Right now? Across the river, there's two places. The High Life Club or Fat Eddie's.
You sure he's there?
That's what the word is. I'll pass the hat down at the Union Hall for both of you.
Is Gus alone over there?
He is now, but there's going to be a crowd.
What do you mean?
I told you.
Yeah.
When Eddie Newman gets back, I gotta tell him.
I knew it was a silly move. Newman had 100 guns on tour for Gus. Cage and the boys from headquarters were standing by for seconds. Helping Gus Trudeau was out of order, but I couldn't get one thing out of my mind. If Gus did kill Courtney, why didn't he pick up some travel money before he did it? I was backward. If you're going to hang up your pants, you take them off first. Well, it was about 3 a.m. when I got down to the river and crossed over to the Kansas side. The High Life Club was smoked up and had a little of everything, except Gus Trudeau. I looked in the kitchen and tried a back room. Then I went to the bar to see if I could drum up some talk. I had one taker, a boy with wavy black hair. He got up from a table of three others, walked over and sat down next to me.
Hello. Come in your office?
No, it's the first time.
Welcome, then. Buy a drink?
No, I'm all set. Try one yourself.
Oh, I think drinking is all right, but I hate people who drink too much, don't you?
You work here?
Well, not regularly. Sometimes I dance and the other act doesn't show up. You here alone? Waiting for someone?
Waiting for a guy named Gus Trudeau.
You one of his friends?
I'm it. Where is he?
He left a while ago. I'm not sure where he
went. Well, get sure. It's important.
When he mentioned someone named Bethy,
I... All right, hold it.
Well, what are you here, Kelly?
All right, get away, Newman. Try another stool.
This'll do.
If he asked you to leave, I think you should leave.
Well, well. Choir boy. That's nice.
Leave him alone.
Who is he?
I never saw him before.
What's he know about Trudeau?
Nothing.
Don't kid me. You're not here to spend the time of day. You're here for Trudeau. You, little friend, where's Gus Trudeau?
I don't have to talk to you. I'm a guest in this place.
You're not anymore. Now climb down and head for that door, both of you.
You can't make us do that. We're not going to leave.
It's a split vote, Buster. I don't like the way he pushes.
That's right. Just walk. I'll bet you look good.
I knew right then. As we walked out, I knew Eddie Newman wasn't going to leave him alone. He was going to pick at him. Whether he knew anything about Gus Trudeau or not, it was going to get messy. And the boy with the nice eyes was going to help. Outside, it wasn't snowing anymore, but the ground was covered right down to the river. The moon out, and it looked all right, if you like nature. We walked over toward a bunch of trees. Newman's car was parked there, a black touring sedan with a strong-arm guy in the back seat. There was another one sitting on the running board. He had a machine gun across his lap.
This'll do. All right. Now let's hear about Gus Trudeau.
I don't know anything about him. This man and I were just talking.
Go easy, Newman. I never saw him before.
He always talked to strangers. Bet he does.
None of your business.
Where's Gus Trudeau?
I wouldn't tell you. Suppose I knew, I wouldn't tell you.
Oh, yes, you would.
Get your hands off of me.
Stop pressing, Newman. You don't care about Trudeau now. You just don't like this guy.
Stay out, Kelly. Come here, you.
Kelly, don't.
Stop screeching. I'll break your arm off.
Keep your hands off of me, you big, dirty pig.
You're in trouble, fella. Shut up.
He is a pig. His hands are dirty and his feet are dirty. No fit, even his clothes are dirty. Oh, that knife.
Now, lay there. All right, Dave, move in here. Back away, Kelly. You're up, choir boy.
Please, please, mister, do something. Don't let a thing like this happen.
It already has, Buster.
No.
Come on, Dave. It's getting cold.
Newman climbed into the car and they drove off. I stayed there a minute to look at the guy in the snow. His face was unmarked. I did him a favor. I rolled him over so it showed in the moonlight. I know his mother'd want him to look good the night Eddie Newman's chopper squad cut him down. Well, the name Bessie had to mean Fat Annie's place up the river on the Kansas side. I made it there and found Bessie. She was back at the piano wandering around somewhere in the middle of the blues. You couldn't miss that voice if she took up yodeling. Bessie Smith.
Pete.
All right, Bessie. What do you know?
Well, I'm back, Pete. You go up the stairs, the loft. Way up there at the top.
Thanks, Bessie.
Okay, Pete. All right, Eddie.
I felt my way out around back and up a couple of flights of stairs that didn't creak in time with the music. There was a door at the top. I pushed it open. He was hunched back on a pile of hay in the corner. He sat up and blinked a couple of times. There wasn't much left, just the frame. And rattling around inside, a lot of tired echoes that wouldn't lay down and die. There was an empty gin bottle on the floor.
Petey, I knew you'd get here.
Yeah, well, they didn't make it easy.
You're looking good, Petey.
Everything's 6-2 and even, huh?
You forget easy, Gus. You're in a jam. You broke jail.
Yeah, I told him all about you up there, Petey. I told him there's another Gus Trudeau blowing down in Kansas City. I'm proud of you, Petey.
Yeah, sure, Gus.
You're just like me, Pete. I told him all about you. You're the only good thing I ever done. I knew you'd come through. Car and some money, Pete. It'll do everything. It'll make it all new. Is it too much to ask? You tell me, Pete.
They want you for Dutch Courtney.
You know better, Pete. I didn't kill Dutch.
Well, you had a reason.
Did I? I forget.
He hung a frame on you, Gus. 5 years worth, remember?
I didn't kill Dutch. Give me a drink, a boy.
No, not tonight.
Don't preach at me. Just something to help me on.
Oh, yeah, now come in out of the fog, Gus. You're going to get a drink or a train ticket for me. Take your pick, because it's the last time around.
Just listen to that. Bessie's still going strong, ain't she?
Yeah, and so are the cops. I got one idea for you, Gus. Get moving.
You remember Chicago, Petey? You and Madge. Chicago always liked me.
You checked out, Gus. Beiderbecke's got your chair.
They'll remember me and you, Petey. I found you when you were nothing.
What are you going to do? Where are you going?
I got it all set up. It's big and brand new. A place in Mexico.
Yeah?
The guy who bunked in my cell with me, his mother runs a place down there. It'll be just like it used to be.
Well, you won't get there on a gin bottle.
I got it set up, boy. A car and some money. It's not much to ask. You haven't got a drink, have you?
You can drink in Mexico. Where are you dreaming up the car and the dough?
It's fixed, boy. You just see this guy and tell him I'm ready. Abe Gaffney. He's got a place on Pershing Road. You know it?
Yeah, I know it. Abe's doing all this?
Just tell him I'm ready. How's Madge?
She's all right.
Come and see me, huh? It's hot down in Mexico.
Gets hot here.
What's the matter, Pete? You ain't sore, are you?
No, I ain't sore. I'm just tired. I'll tell Gaffney and then I'm checking out. Goodbye, Gus.
You're not getting too big for your old friends, are you, boy?
Friends are like everything else, Gus.
Yeah?
They wear out on you. Wasn't any different than a dozen times before. I knew there wasn't very much left, but I wasn't looking for a second-rate ghost with an empty gin bottle. Well, I crossed the river to the Missouri side, headed down Main Street, and then I swung over toward Abe Gaffney's place on Pershing Road. It was pushing close to 5:30 a.m. The sun wasn't up yet, and the night was too tired to care. I pulled up in front of the Murad sign out in front of Gaffney's. Inside, a counterman with pimples and coffee was leaning on last night's paper. A beaded curtain shut off the hallway that led back to Gaffney's room.
You want something?
Yeah, Gaffney.
Not here.
Where do I find him?
I don't know.
I was supposed to meet him here.
That's so?
Look, this is Gaffney's place. Where is he?
I told you.
Now, listen, Junior. Maybe you think you do a good imitation of Calvin Coolidge, but I want an answer. Where's Gaffney?
What's your name?
Kelly.
You could have saved an argument this way. Through the curtain.
When do you go to bed, Kelly?
Yeah. You still looking, Newman?
I'm still asking. Where's Guts?
I don't think you'd give me time to answer.
There's a good reason why I let you walk away tonight. I gave you 2 hours all by yourself on the Kansas side. I don't think you threw him away. You got a line on Gus Trudeau, and I want it.
I got nothing for you.
Don't be silly, Pete. The cops get him, or I do. He goes either way.
You get no help from me.
I don't want help. I want Gus. Now, come on! Come on! Come on, or I'll make you part of the wallpaper.
You better send for Dave.
I don't need it.
I think you do. Now, don't bother to get up. I'm leaving.
I don't believe it. Wasn't your turn, Kelly.
When I got up off the floor, the room was cold and the lights were out. Newman was gone, but I knew he was still in business. I knew if he didn't find Gus Trudeau this trip, he'd come back for me. Well, I got into Red's car and followed the radiator cap back to 417. I found off the back of the stand having breakfast.
Did you bring an egg, Peter? Kitchen's closed down.
Newman been back here?
I haven't noticed. You look abused.
Yeah. Did anybody say anything?
Who missed? You heard the news?
What's that?
They found the guy who got Dutch Courtney. Fellow by the name of Doyle. East St. Louis. Cops got the goods on it. Gun, fingerprints, the works.
What was his beef with Dutch?
Doyle owned East St. Louis. Dutch wouldn't believe it.
I'll leave it to Gus. If there's a hole, he'll fall in it.
Makes it easier, doesn't it? Newman will call his boys off now. Well,
somebody better tell him in a hurry.
Did you see Gus?
Yeah, I saw him. He's trying to get out of town.
Pete, Todd?
That's right.
Dave Gaffney, Pete.
Well, you're a hard man to find.
Newman came in the front door. I went out the back. This won't take long. Car keys and money for Gus.
Well, you got the wrong guy, Abe. I quit an hour ago.
Fight it out with yourself. Car's out in the alley. Gray Chandler. Tell Gus is low on gas.
No, wait a minute. You can take this stuff to Gus. You know where he is.
No, thanks. You take care of Gus. He's an old friend.
What's the matter with you?
I hardly know him.
The clock over the bar said 6:15. We got back on the stand and started the last set. 80 pounds of stale cigarette smoke was holding up the ceiling, waving down in a dirty blue curtain over the dance floor. Behind the bar, one of the guys was wiping up. Two couples picked their way to the dance floor, pushed each other around a while, and finally gave up. Oh, the whole thing, it was all out of step. Wrinkled stockings, brown gardenias, torn paper hats, and Gus Trudeau. He walked in the door and stood off to one side, just back of the stand.
Hey, Pete, Gus got here. He's safe now.
Don't make buck on it. All right, last one. The blues in B-flat. That's it. Same call tonight, 10 o'clock. You can pop up.
Pete, over here.
I heard you. You sound good, Pete. Just what I told him up there. You're on your way, boy.
All right, now you heard it, Gus. Here's the money. And the car keys. I'll see you, Gus.
You know what I told him? Another Gus Trudeau is blown down to Kansas City.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, boy. I believe it.
Happy New Year, Gus.
Hi, Madge.
Hold it there, Pete. It's a family fight. Stay out.
I thought I took that gun away from you.
What's the matter, Madge? What are you doing?
Don't tell me that talk, Gus. Dutch can't hear you.
What do you mean, Madge?
You killed him. You blew your top and killed him just like you did everything else for me. You and that gin and that cheap brass horn of yours. You sped us all, Pete and me. You ran through the whole bunch till you got to Dutch.
Hey, I didn't do anything.
You killed Dutch Courtney. I loved him. I loved him enough to square it.
I got it wrong, Madge.
Goodbye, Gus. I'll sound the stray your horn in after you.
Read the paper, Madge. He killed the wrong brother.
Stay away, Pete.
It's in the paper, Madge. A guy by the name of Doyle. He killed Dutch.
They're not sure. Are they?
They're sure.
What'll I do?
I got two things for you, Madge. And the car keys. Now, you see what you can do with 10 minutes start.
You didn't have anything more for Gus, did you, Pete?
No, I guess not.
Well... Maybe.
Yeah, just finally got out of town.
Pete Kelly's Blues, starring Jack Webb, with story by Jim Moser, music by Dick Cathcart, scoring by Matty Matlock. Pete Kelly's Blues is based on characters created by Richard L. Breen.